spent all this time trying to play now. I found my way here.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome back to Beyond Zoom 2. I hope everybody found yesterday's program as fascinating as I did. I think that both the keynote and the lightning talks were some really great introductions to projects. And the glue session last night was really interesting. I haven't been in that platform much before, and that showed some really good potential, I thought. So I very much appreciate them making that available for us to have our happy hour last night. This morning, we're going to kick off with a session that was inspired by the feedback we got from the last Beyond Zoom conference. We were told afterwards in surveys that one of the things that people were looking for is, okay, it's nice to talk about all these grants. How do you actually do all these projects? How do you actually do them? And part of that is funding them. So what we've done is we've ask some people who are experts in that to come join us and talk to us for a little while. This session is going to be led by Marianne Ellis of HP Grant Support and Liz Shea of Grants Office LLC. And they're going to tell you a little bit about the funding landscape for these sort of virtual reality projects that we're talking about. So Liz, Marianne, take it away.
Thank you so much. Let me just pop up my screen. Awesome. So as John just said, today we're going to be talking about grants to help fund your project initiatives. Go ahead, Marianne.
All right. Thanks, Liz. Hi, everyone. My name is Marianne Ellis, and I am the program manager for the HP Grant Support Program. On behalf of HP, I'm so pleased to welcome you to today's session. HP and partners AMD, Microsoft, and Intel have had a long-standing partnership and during the pandemic shared a common goal to work together to support schools, teachers, and students in need. Out of this has come several initiatives. We've joined forces with Grants Office LLC, Liz and the team over there, and they bring a host of grants experience to our projects. We're excited today to share information about grant-seeking opportunities, along with some information about how you can get complimentary support through the HP Grant Support Program. Again, thank you for joining us today. Liz, let's get started.
Awesome, sounds great. So just to kind of start out this conversation, I'm gonna talk a little bit about some of the most popular grants that can help fund your VR initiatives as well as other initiatives. In general, what we see is that grant makers are pretty agnostic about the kinds of technology that you're using or any of those kinds of specifics. What they really care about is things like the student learning outcomes or the research that you're enabling or the workforce development that you're enabling. So as I talk about these grants, know that they're all super technology friendly. Just focus really on those kind of project aspects of this, which I'm sure all of you are really interested in doing. So in the grant space, there's a few different areas that grants can come in. The first is federal government grants, as well as nationally focused foundation grants. They tend to focus on a lot of different topics, things like higher education and workforce development, learning and learning research. They provide pass-through opportunities, which means they provide funding to each individual state, and then those states make some decisions about how that funding is shared. They also support research programs as well as research infrastructure. And then there's also these nationally focused foundations that really support projects anywhere in the country. The state governments also have a lot of grant opportunities, some of those being those pass-through ones that I mentioned already, as well as states creating their own grant programs that really help the focus areas of whatever's going on within their state specifically. And then finally, there's regionally focused foundations. So a bunch of different programs that focus maybe on one state or a few states or even potentially just a smaller region. So looking in this kind of first area, we're not going to talk too much about state grants today or regionally focused grants because Obviously, you guys aren't all from exactly the same place, but we're going to talk about some of these more nationally focused things. The first area, and definitely a super popular area, is the higher education and workforce development area. These are just a sample of a few different grants that are very popular. I'm not going to talk about all of them in detail today, but know that these are a few that you could look into a little bit more, even if I don't talk about them today. And this is definitely not an exhaustive list either. So the first I'm going to talk about is the Improving Undergraduate STEM Education, Education and Human Resources. This program is cool because it has three deadlines per year, so you don't have to wait as long necessarily as you're starting to apply for it. The next one that comes up is on August 3rd. This program has two different tracks. The first is the Engaged Student Learning, which focuses on design, development, and research of tools, resources, or models to help in STEM education. Focuses on student initiatives, faculty professional development, or research on teaching and learning more broadly. This is definitely the most popular track for teams that are looking at VR initiatives or other similar kinds of initiatives in the STEM learning space. There's also the Institutional and Community Transformation track. This focuses on systematic changes across a much larger group. So things like departments, colleges within an institute of higher education, an entire institute of higher education, or even a group of institutes of higher education, or potentially the STEM community very broadly or nationally. The goal really across the board is for novel, creative, and transformative approaches for STEM teaching and learning, to improve STEM teaching and learning for undergraduate students specifically. In this particular program, that's really the group that they care about. Obviously, things that you can learn might be able to extend to other groups as well, but the goal of this particular program and what the National Science Foundation is really focused on is the undergraduate side of things. So the solicitation or request for proposals is out now. The National Science Foundation, as I mentioned, does three deadlines a year. And so they've already released the solicitation for 2021. Depending on the track that you apply for, as well as how much experience you have, they divide this program into three different levels, not necessarily experience about this particular grant, but experience on the kind of project you're working on. Funding could be anywhere from $150,000 to $3 million for 2 to 5 years, depending on exactly what you're doing. So a pretty good amount of funding potential from a relatively small project up to a pretty large project. Institutes of higher education are the main applicants, as you might expect, since the focus is undergraduate education. Other organizations can also apply in this case. They don't ban them, but definitely institutes of higher education are the most popular. The next of the programs I want to talk about is Advanced Technological Education, or ATE. This is another National Science Foundation program. We see this line come around in October. We usually see it come around in October every year. So this particular program is focused on STEM technician training. And you can see along the top, there's a bunch of different fields that the National Science Foundation focuses on. But the main goal is to support STEM technician training in the 2-year college space. So these programs can support a variety of different types of projects or components of projects, a big one being program development and improvement, as well as curriculum and educational materials development, definitely both really relevant as you're trying to create educational projects in innovative spaces. It also can do professional development for educators, leadership capacity building for faculty members, do teacher training so that K-12 teachers can support the career and technical education space, potentially for high schoolers. Also teaching business and entrepreneurial skills development for students, as well as instrumentation acquisition so that you can do curricular modifications. So it doesn't just buy technology for the sake of technology, as we've already mentioned, but if you're modifying the curriculum and need technology to make that happen, definitely fits under this, which again, really lines up with some of the things that are being discussed at this conference. And I just want to mention a cool component of this project as well. There is a bucket within the broader ATE program called Small Grants for Institutions New to ATE. This is specifically for community colleges that haven't really had experience with this program or with the National Science Foundation, and it creates prototype programs. In this particular case, you're competing only against other institutions that have never really done these kinds of grants before. And they also have something called the Mentor Connect program, which can connect you to an institution that has a lot of experience with ATE. and have them help mentor you through the application process, as well as if you win the award, mentoring you through the rest of the actually implementing the project. So usually the solicitation is released sometime in midsummer. They usually release several years of deadlines at a time. In this particular case, 2020 was the last year on the previous round of solicitations. So we'll expect to see it coming back around. Funding is usually $75,000 to $600,000 for 2 to 3 years. Again, depending on which funding track you apply for, there's several different funding tracks depending on the kind of project that you're proposing. Two-year degree granting institutions should be the lead applicant in all cases. That's really what the National Science Foundation is looking for. But other institutes of higher education, as well as businesses and nonprofits, can partner with them to help facilitate, say, focusing on a specific workforce development aspect that's applicable to the local business or something like that. And then the last one I'm going to talk about in this little group of grants is Humanities Connections. Usually this program comes about in September of each year. So this particular program is focused on a humanities field as well as another field, usually in the social and natural sciences. And the goal is to kind of develop curriculum at this intersection. So it integrates subject matter, perspectives, and goals from two or more disciplines. One has to be inside humanities and one has to be outside of humanities. And the goal is also to help facilitate collaboration between the faculty members of those different departments or different schools. They include experiential learning as a component of any project that you would propose. And then there's also plans for longer term institutional support for whatever innovation you create. So whatever programming you develop at this intersection, you have to talk about how your institution plans to continue to support that in the long term. So, excuse me, as we can see again, solicitations are usually available in midsummer. They usually give you about 60 days to apply once they have released the solicitation. So usually that falls into September. Funding is a little bit smaller because the National Endowment for the Humanities just tends to give smaller funding amounts than the National Science Foundation, but they do $35,000 to $100,000 for 1 to 3 years. All different types of colleges and universities are eligible to apply, be it public, private, liberal arts, community colleges, whatever that might be. They specifically call out minority serving institutions, HBCUs, TCUs, et cetera, as being a particular focus area, but all types of institutions can apply. So the next kind of area here are the non-education focused projects. So there's a variety of different areas that these fall under as well. Some of these at the top, for example, are really research intensive projects and utilizing, say, virtual reality technology or whatever that might be within a research project. And then down at the bottom, you can see a few grants that are really more about production of something, a product of some sort in that kind of innovative space. So the first of the grants I'm going to talk about today is the SCISE Core Program, Cyber Human Systems. This is out of the National Science Foundation. You might have noticed a trend. They're really interested in innovation in a lot of different spaces within STEM. The SCISE is the Computer and Information Sciences and Engineering. This program is expected to have a deadline in September. So the goal of this program is to focus on human-computer interaction taken pretty broadly. So they are interested in computational and behavioral sciences and kind of how they can mesh together, how computing systems can amplify humans' capabilities or lack of capabilities in various areas. As you can see on the screen, there's several different areas that they specifically call out as being interested in. Some of these that are really applicable, human-technology interfaces, computer technology for creativity, computer-based collaboration and communication, assistive and adaptive technologies really kind of all play a role in this particular case. They also do other areas such as, say, social impacts of computing. How does computing influence us as a society or us as individuals? This particular program releases solicitations in late fall each year. They usually give you about 90 days to apply once they release the solicitation, and they fund from $250,000 to $1.4 million across 2 to 3 years. So colleges and universities can apply for any of the tracks. There's several different tracks that they divide up the program into depending on focus areas. There's also a couple of tracks that nonprofit, non-academic institutions may apply for. This applies to the small institutions track as well as the cyber teams track. Another program that's really cool is the digital projects for the public grant. This should be due on June 9th of this year. So this particular program supports projects that interpret and analyze humanities, usually in digital platforms or formats, and it's designed to attract broad public audiences. So the goal is to deepen the public understanding of significant humanities ideas. They also have a few different areas that they are looking for any project. They want to have sound humanities scholarship involved. They want humanities scholars so that that can actually happen. Digital media professionals so that you have the digital know-how to make the digital platforms and formats really work for the public. The goal is to reach a broad public audience, so they expect a plan for development, marketing, and distribution of whatever you're doing, and then a capacity to sustain the project beyond the length of the grant. So the National Endowment for the Humanities supports a few different levels for these projects. The first would be discovery. So this is a really early stage planning project. Next comes up prototyping. So if you start to build the project, a mini version of the project, or they could fund a production stage where you really finish up the project, make the full project as it's meant to be, as well as work on distribution so that the public can actually experience it. This particular year, they mention a special interest in their focus area, which is A More Perfect Union, focused on the 250th anniversary of the country. But they do expect projects in other areas as well. That's just a highlight that they point out. So the RFP is already out. As I mentioned, it's due in June. And so funding can range from $30,000 to $400,000, depending on which track, that design, prototyping, or production, as well as how big your project really is. A few different types of organizations can apply. Nonprofit organizations, this would include institutes of higher education, as well as state and local government agencies and tribal governments. So a little different than some of the ones that we've talked about thus far, in that the government can kind of take a lead role on any of these projects. And then kind of the last focus area that I want to talk about is some foundations with a national focus. This is definitely not an exhaustive list by any means, but these are three really popular large foundations that really support a lot of different areas in both education, especially in the higher education space, as well as in the research space. One that I want to point out specifically is the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation. So foundations are pretty cool because many of them will accept applications at any time. So you can kind of just get started whenever you are ready to get started. And they also frequently start with a letter of intent. So a short application that's only one or two pages, written typically as a letter to them, just telling them a little bit about your project. So the burden to kind of get started on any of these applications is a lot lower. So this can be a really good place to start if you've never done grants before or never done grants in this kind of area before. So the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation has a few different areas that they focus on, one being STEM higher education. And you can see they have a few different topic areas even within that. But the main goal is to support STEM higher education. So kind of in line with some of those National Science Foundation grants that we talked about, but also other areas within STEM higher education. The next is public understanding of science, technology, and economics. So this is production of some sort of product so that the public can better understand STEM-related fields. They specifically call out new media as one of the areas of focus. So definitely could be applicable to some of these kind of more innovative technologies, as well as you can do things like radio and books that have been around for obviously a very long time. And then they also support research. There's a few different areas of research that they're supporting right now, but kind of anywhere broadly within there, they can support research projects. Typically, these are kind of pilot-sized projects that can then be built up potentially in a future round through maybe a National Science Foundation grant or something like that if you wanted to extend it even further in the future. So as I mentioned, the solicitation, to the extent that the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation provides a solicitation, their information is all out now. Funding amounts vary quite broadly. Foundations usually don't specify quite as strictly as you see with, say, federal funders or state funders. They kind of want to know that whatever you are asking for is the correct amount for the kinds of things that you are asking for and the kinds of projects that you're proposing. So it can vary quite a bit, sometimes as small as say $5,000 up to tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of dollars. So they're interested in nonprofit organizations applying. Again, that applies very broadly. So it could include, say, institutes of higher education. And they start out with that letter of inquiry that I mentioned. So just a short letter to them that says who you are and what you want to do and why you think they should care. That why is super important because that's what's going to determine whether they want to get more information from you in a full application, or if they're gonna say, no thanks, this isn't right for us. So really connecting back to any of those priorities that they have and saying, what is the impact going to be and how does it align with the things that this loan foundation cares about? So next I wanna talk a little bit about grant seeking tips. If you haven't had a lot of experience with grants, some of these can really help you out as you are starting to prepare any project that you're working on in this particular space. So the first step is to brainstorm how you can align your technology goals or your project goals with the things that the funder cares about. So as I mentioned briefly at the beginning, the funder doesn't really care about technology. They care about what I tend to call the warm, fuzzy feelings, things like those student learning outcomes, research, workforce development, those kinds of areas. That's what they really care about. So that's what you're really focusing on. And then you talk about how the technology facilitates any of those kinds of things. So asking questions like, where do the solutions that you are interested in using, be it VR technology or whatever that might be, benefit the mission-driven activities that the funder cares about? So whatever they might be focused on, be it say innovative STEM education for the improving undergraduate STEM education program, or maybe STEM technician training with ATE, whatever that might look like. The next step is, why do you need this technology? So just saying, I'm going to do it because we want to use this technology is not really what the funder cares about. They want to know why the solution that you're providing is going to create a really good outcome for whatever your target population is. So if you are working with students, why is the technologies that you're proposing going to help facilitate their education and make them learn better or remember better what they learned or have it be more impactful, whatever that might be? If you are doing, say, a digital projects for the humanity, digital projects for the public grant in the humanities space, how are you going to impact the public? How is this technology going to help them learn that humanities focused area that the grant funder really cares about? Next up is, what are the student learning or research outcomes or benefits that will occur? So what are the outcomes that they care about? Excuse me. So be it student learning in the improving undergraduate STEM education, maybe it's a research outcome in say that size grant that we talked about. Maybe it's an impact for the public in that they're going to better understand say US history, for example, whatever that might be. That's what they really care about. And that's what you need to make sure that you're focused on for those outcomes. The next up is, who at your institution needs to be involved in the discussion. So usually grant projects and really all projects in general are not done in a vacuum. There's probably gonna be a lot of different players involved in any of these conversations. Obviously you're gonna play a really key role since you're the one that's coming up with the project and probably going to implement the project, but you probably want people from your IT department involved to make sure that any technologies that you're proposing will align well with the system more broadly at your institution, so you can actually use it once you win the grant and buy the product. You want the people in the finance office involved because they need to make sure that you're considering all the components of funding that are really important and that your budget makes sense and that you're meeting all the institutional budgetary requirements. A lot of institutions have grants offices. So having those grants offices involved, they might be the ones submitting the grant, they might be helping write the grant, they might take a pretty hands-off approach, but they definitely will need to be involved. In some instances, for some of these grants, there's a limited number of applications that can be submitted by each institution. So in those cases, obviously, it's really important that your grants office knows about it so that you're involved in that internal competition to make sure that your project is one of the ones that's proposed in the application process. Next up, how much money do you need? That's a super important one. Make sure that you are falling within the budgetary requirements of the grant funder for the particular grant that you're working on. but also make sure you're meeting the needs of whatever project you're proposing. So if they don't align fully, is there a way that you could say, do a pilot version of your project using the particular grant funding? Or is there other components that you need to consider? Whenever those kinds of things fall in, those are really important things to consider. Next up is, when do you need it? So if you have a whole event planned out and you're going to involve this, say, in your spring curriculum or your fall curriculum, and so you already need it right now, that's a really important thing to consider. Grant makers can operate on quite varied scales, anywhere from, say, weeks, some foundations can operate that fast, to several months, potentially for some federal funders. So it's really important to make sure that any project that you're proposing will be aligned with that timeline. So for example, if you plan to implement a STEM education program in the fall semester of 2021, probably that improving undergraduate STEM education with an August deadline is not the best fit, because they're not going to make decisions in time for you to start a project in September. Next up is justifying your technology within the overall project budget. As I mentioned, grant funders don't really care about the technology in and of itself. That's just not what they're interested in. They care about the project more broadly. So that's those things that are allowing students to have a better understanding of a particular topic, or allowing the public to better understand a particular topic. Whoever your audience is, that's the part that they care about, and that's the broader project. So thinking about what you need for your project is really important. Just saying that you want this technology because you think that it's cool or you think that it'll be helpful is not enough to really make the funder excited about the project as a whole. You really want to involve your vendors and your IT staff to make sure your project will work. As I mentioned, sometimes certain products don't work with certain networks, for example, or they need additional components or adapters. And I've heard so many horror stories of things not really going right. So making sure to get your IT staff involved will help make sure that any project that you are proposing, all the products that you include on there will actually work in the end. Also include your vendors. They will be able to give you accurate quotes, which is super important. So the quotes that they provide can help you with your budget when you are submitting your budget. Their expertise can help you with the budget justification, where you explain why you need each of the things that you say that you need. And then also it shows that you've really done your homework. So grant funders know that you haven't just pulled a random number off the internet. They know that the number that they see on your budget is really a real number and is exactly what you're going to need. And you're not going to be coming back to them and say, oh, I need another $20,000 or something like that later, because you know that it's exactly what you're going to need. In your budget justification, you're going to want to talk about each piece of equipment that you're including in a way that is very understandable to all the reviewers. So I usually think about it as, talk to your grandma or talk to your neighbor or somebody like that. If they can understand what technology, like why you need that technology and how it fits to those grant funded activities, that's the kind of level that you want to be writing for. You don't want to be using a lot of technical jargon, because as a whole, the reviewers are not necessarily as tech savvy as you are or as your team might be. So make sure you talk about how this technology relates to one or more of the project goals that you list, whatever goals you're listing, be it students learning a particular concept or maybe you have a particular research outcome that you're hoping for. That's the really important part. So you can see this picture on the side, which doesn't really make a lot of sense up until now, but I tend to think about it as you're baking a cake. So your project is the cake, and that's what the grant funders really care about, is that cake. Your technology is the eggs. So grant funders might not really care about the eggs, and even if you tell them these are free-range chickens and they are organic and they're grown, the chickens are housed down the street from your house, whatever that might be, that's all well and good, but the grant funder mostly cares about the cake. And once they've taken a bite of the cake, they might really get curious about all the other components that go into it. So now that they know the cake is delicious, they want to know about your, about the eggs. They also want to know about where you got your butter and if your flour is something that you just regularly keep in your pantry or if it's something special. All of those kinds of things, they start to get curious once they have had the cake. So the cake is that project, that warm, fuzzy feeling, all of those kinds of things. And then once you get there, your budget justification will explain all those components, things like your eggs and your butter, and exactly why you need those and why they help make the cake delicious. So collaboration is also an area that I want to talk about because it can be a really beneficial way to help out any of the projects that you propose. There are a lot of different reasons that it might be worth partnering and that can definitely benefit you in a lot of ways. One is it can help you accomplish mutual goals. So maybe you're talking to somebody else who has a similar or related goal and you can kind of kill two birds with one stone, as it were, by working together. It also reduces duplication of efforts. So you don't want two different people at your institution or in your town or whatever it might be, trying to do the same kind of project to reach the same kind of audience because you're just not gonna get the same kind of impact. It means you can also share your resources. It might cost you less because you can pull together the resources that you have to help make these projects happen. It also can open up new opportunities. So if you start to think about, for example, maybe you work in the humanities or in the arts, but you have a project that could potentially be at the intersection with a STEM field. Well, now you open up some new opportunities that you might not have otherwise considered, because if your project actually is at that intersection and you collaborate with somebody in the STEM space, it's possible that the project that you propose could fit under an interest of, say, the National Science Foundation, which, as we saw, offers a lot of grant opportunities that could be relevant. They also have pretty good sized funding buckets, which can be really helpful. So being able to position yourself in those kinds of other spaces might open up new ways of thinking or new opportunities. Obviously you shouldn't be proposing things that you're not interested in doing or don't fit, but if you're kind of in a space where you're like, hey, maybe I'm at the intersection, but I don't personally have the expertise to talk about, say, the STEM aspects of this project, being able to collaborate might open up those other opportunities. It also helps you build a well-rounded project because you have people who have different areas of expertise. They can come together and make sure that you're really covering all the different components that matter. So in terms of building these collaborations and establishing your team, you want to be purposeful in selecting who you're working with. Don't just work with anybody just because they say that they're willing to work with you or they have time, or just because you want the money, for example. That's not going to be what makes you passionate about your project, and grant funders are definitely going to notice if you're not passionate about your project. Make sure you loop in those partners before you fully plan the project. If you've already had everything planned and you just want them to sign off on it, they're probably not going to be that interested because it doesn't feel like their project. So make sure that they're involved and make sure that they can bring their expertise to any project that you are proposing during this planning stage. Typically, this works out best by planning some sort of introductory meeting. Everyone can talk about what they can offer for the particular project. You can talk about how you're going to be involved. In many cases, you might need a principal investigator. So you might want to work out who's going to be the principal investigator, or if you're going to have a couple principal investigators that are working together. You also want to solidify what it means to be successful. So what exactly is each person or each team member trying to get out of this particular project? And what is their impact trying to be? And how do those fit together to create an overall project goal? In many cases, it's worth it to write letters of commitment or memoranda of understanding, especially if you're different organizations. You want to make sure that you have those kinds of things. Grant makers are going to want to make sure that you have those kinds of things when you submit the application, because they want to know that all the players in any application are really serious, but also you want to have that kind of security of, you know, that everyone is really dedicated to this project. So just to kind of close this section, strong partners can make a solid specific contribution to a grant funded project, and this can help push your proposal up to the lead as you're applying, assuming all other aspects are held equal. So if grant funders have two really cool projects that they have in front of them, one of the areas that they're really going to focus on is who is involved in collaboration, because that might make a really a stronger project in the end, because you have more people with more areas of expertise that are being involved and can have the same kind of impact in the final project. So having a collaboration doesn't automatically make you more successful, but it can definitely help push you ahead once you already have a strong application. With that, I'm going to hand things back to Marianne.
Thanks so much, Liz. That was a lot of really great information. I hope you all found it valuable. Before we conclude, I want to share with you information about how you can get support for your grant-seeking efforts through the HP Grant Support Program, which is sponsored by AMD, Microsoft, and Intel. As I mentioned earlier, HP and partners shared a common goal to help schools during these difficult days. And knowing the challenges you are all facing and understanding that budgets and time were more constrained than ever, we teamed up with Grants Office to create a no-cost, yep, that's right, no-cost support program designed to help schools find grants funding for technology projects. This program provides additional assistance as well. Liz and team can also serve as additional resources to your internal grants team, and they provide very valuable consulting to help you select the right grant opportunities and to help you position your grant for success. They can even help review your grant proposals. The experience that they bring helps save you time and can help you move forward more quickly and more strategically. Engaging with the program is very easy. You simply go to grantsoffice.com/HP and you complete a one-page form. And it really asks for who is your HP or channel partner account representative, who is the person that we should contact within your organization, and then just a little bit about your project. What are your technology needs? What are you hoping to accomplish with your project? And a little bit about the background of the team, you know, whether you have, if you're a beginner grant seeker or if you have a great deal of experience. And what that does is it helps Liz and team then go off and start working on a customized funding report that will contain a whole host of grant opportunities for you to consider. And about 7 to 10 days after you submit that initial form, you're going to receive a copy of that funding report. And you can see an example on the right side of the screen here. It can be a very long document, somewhere between, you know, anywhere from 20 to 80 pages. You don't need to review the whole document before coming to a consultation call, but to kind of get a flavor for what's available and be able to have a conversation with your grants consultant, where she will go into background of what your needs are, what your project's all about, the various grant opportunities that she's researched for you, and understanding that every school has a different situation in terms of grants expertise and resources, this program team will custom tailor our interactions with you so you can take advantage of as much as or as little as the program offers. So thank you again for your time in joining us today. To learn more about the HP Grant Support Program and the grants that Liz has discussed, you can go to grantsoffice.com/HP. And to go directly to the consultation request form, you can see the link here, and we'll make sure that we get that out to all of you. And now I'll turn it back over to John for questions.
Thank you very much, Marianne and Liz. That was excellent information. And as a couple of people have mentioned in the chat here, they're wondering if the slides that you used are going to be available somewhere. Are those public anywhere?
We can get them over to you, John, so that they can be distributed to everybody. Absolutely.
Excellent. Thanks. Some questions have come in. The first one on the list is, what kind of grants would you recommend for graduate schools in public health?
Oh, that's a great question. That really depends on the kind of thing that you are focused on. There are some grants that focus on the education side of things. I will say public health is probably not the most popular area in the federal space for whatever reason. Right now, they're focused really on the research side of things more than the education side of things. Obviously, in the research space, there's tons of grants right now on public health related things or COVID specifically in those kinds of cases sometimes. in the education space, I think for public health, probably the most popular area is there's some foundations that are really interested in that for sure. Many of those are regionally focused, so which specific ones really depends on where you're located and who you are as an organization.
Great, thanks. And I missed who put that in, but if whoever submitted that wants to reply in the chat and just follow up on it, happy to pass that along as well. Next question is, many of these grants have public impact requirements. You mentioned them, and some are specifically aimed at broad impacts. VR hardware is getting more popular, and better and less expensive headsets are coming out, but there's not necessarily a lot of it out there. So how are people making the argument that VR projects are going to have a broad impact when many people don't have access to the hardware yet?
Yeah, so in some cases, it's focused on the education side of things. I would say it's focused mainly on you're able to demonstrate that this is a viable approach to education and that you're providing new educational techniques and new educational opportunities, and you're reaching students in a different way, potentially in a better way than maybe some other kinds of education, which provides kind of a test case that says other institutions should start investing in providing this kind of technology. And it provides the evidence that they need so that other institutions start using it as well. Also, potentially they create their own innovations then, because they're like, oh, there was this study that showed that it worked in say this physics 101 class. Maybe now I want to apply it to a quantum mechanics class kind of thing, and push it in the next stage of innovation, for example. In terms of some of those ones for really the public broadly, at this point, I think it's more of an installation kind of environment where people can come and use VR technologies and really try it out, because obviously at this point, it is still relatively uncommon to be able to say, hey, just download this thing and you can start using it in your living room. Although I think we're definitely heading in that direction in the next several years. But I think that grant makers kind of understand that we're still at that transition phase. So a digital project for the public doesn't necessarily mean it can go into individual homes. It could go into, say, a public installation that people can come and try it out at City Hall or a museum or wherever that might be, and show that it's a cool way for people to be able to learn and experience those kinds of things.
And I'm just curious, because it does certainly seem like that's the direction we're going. Have people been able to make persuasive arguments that, okay, we're going to work on the project now, we're going to generate this thing, we're going to release it 3 years from now, and 3 years from now, we expect there to be better penetration of VR hardware in the public. Does that work?
So I haven't seen that too much in federal grants yet. That doesn't mean that it can't happen. It just, thus far, I haven't seen that happen too much in kind of that federal space at this point. Probably partially just because government moves slowly. That's kind of their thing. So they, as much as they want to push innovation, maybe not quite as much innovation as we might see in other spaces. I do think that there are foundations that are supporting that kind of project at this point, and being able to say, we're going to start prototyping it now. And we know that 3 years from now or 5 years from now, when we have a final super cool version of this, more people are going to be able to access it. Or in other cases, being able to present a version that could still be enjoyable, even if it wasn't truly VR, but some sort of kind of interactive environment that they could still use even just on their phones, but then have an additional component added on top of it that makes it even better, obviously, if they could use VR. That's also a way that it's been proposed. And we've seen that a little bit as well.
Thank you. Next question. Does the HP grant support program only support schools, or do you provide this service to any nonprofit in general?
That's a great question. We definitely support the schools, but we've also supported state and local community agencies. It does need to be a nonprofit. And when we receive those kinds of requests, we do work with each of the requesters to ensure that their nonprofit status is, you know, what it needs to be for the program. I I would suggest that you reach out to us and that we explore together.
Great, thanks. And somewhat related to that, also another question. As educators, is there any benefit to trying to partner with private or public museums? And I'll extend that to other nonprofit organizations as well. Do they tend to make good partners?
I mean, I don't know if I can say across the board if they're good partners or not. But I think from a grants perspective, there's definitely a possibility. So if you go for, say, one of those digital projects for the public or one of those kinds of public outreach grants, partnership is pretty much going to be required because, especially if you were, say, an institution of higher education, you're probably going to be better off if you have someplace that's not necessarily your campus for people to be able to access the digital project. But we also see a lot of cases where there are benefits for partnering for other reasons. So maybe they bring a certain kind of expertise, maybe they bring a different population. So one of the grants that I listed on here but didn't talk about was the Advancing Informal STEM Learning. This program is for non-classroom STEM education. So kind of the flip side of we saw with like IUs, for example, with the Improving Undergraduate STEM Education. That kind of thing doesn't require a partnership. An institute of higher education could do it by themselves, but you're probably going to be a lot more compelling if you say we're going to have a component of our project that anybody who shows up at the museum will participate in, for example. So those kinds of things can definitely really make a project more compelling and make it more competitive in those cases.
And I can just also kick in and say that as far as the museum aspect of it goes, if you're going to do that, the recommendation I would give is to talk to them very early on and make sure that they're involved in the development of process of the grant as well, rather than just sort of being tacked on at the end as a, hey, we need some place to show this. There's a museum next door. Let's go there. They're going to be very interested in what goes into their space as a museum, and they're going to know their patrons very well. So they'll be really good partners in that sense, certainly.
Yeah, definitely do that whole memoranda of understanding, introductory meetings, all of that stuff, because otherwise they will be grumpy and no one will be happy in the end.
Indeed. And following up on that, there's another comment and question here. The New York City Consortium of XR Events Group has done many of these kinds of public event installations that demonstrate very valuable project displays. Is there a curated list of examples of these kinds of public showcases that you know of?
I don't know of one off the top of my head. Do you know of one?
I don't, but it would be, I think that's something that we might want to look into, because I think that one of the things that I know I certainly, when I've been writing these sort of grants, have struggled with sometimes is just finding predicates. Certainly there's a lot in, sorry, I don't mean to take this over. There's a lot in the sort of art space that is my background that you could look at as, okay, this is technically a previous version of the kinds of installation that we're talking about here. And those are floating around, but I haven't seen any specifically geared at XR in the kinds of learning spaces that we've been talking about.
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot of information out there, but it's definitely sometimes difficult to find because it's kind of disparate at this point, I think. So in the grant space, sometimes you can find it by seeing what grants have been won and kind of searching, like the National Science Foundation, for example, has a search function to see all their funded projects, and you get like an abstract version of that. I will say it's not super user-friendly, but you do get some information there. And other funders have kind of a similar approach. And then there's always the Google situation, but yeah, it's definitely not like nice, neat, here's a list of, you know, 20 projects that relate to XR or anything like that.
Yeah, the only thing I would suggest is, you know, unfortunately, it's not a compiled list, but the kinds of projects that we've been talking about over the last couple of days and at the previous conference as well, they tend to show up on more sort of popular press sites as this is an interesting public event, you know, so the Gizmodos of the world, and there are various VR blogs that track all of this stuff as well. So it's not a nice, neat compiled list, but it's a way of seeing what's going on. Another question here. So you mentioned mentoring in the context of a specific program with the ATE program. Do you know of resources out there for mentoring that are more broadly applied, or networks of people who are working on these sorts of grants?
Yeah, so there's mostly informal networks, I would say, in terms of those kinds of situations. A lot of, say, your local department when you're at a university, somebody else in the department might have more experience than you have, or maybe you work in partnership with another local organization that's maybe been more involved. So maybe your institution doesn't do it a lot, or your organization doesn't do it a lot, but there's another organization locally that you might want to partner with, and they can kind of provide some mentoring and also partnership simultaneously. There's also always reaching out to us, and we can help out in a lot of those spaces too, since we have experience, not just me, but my team and everyone else I work with. We have a lot of experience in the grant space, so we can kind of help with some of that too. I will say the formal ones, there's only probably two or three formally set up mentorship programs for specific grants.
Gotcha. And I just want to finish out here by asking one question that you and I have talked about before when I've talked to grants office myself. There's a little bit of a disconnect between funding individual projects and then funding larger term or longer scale infrastructure to support all of these sort of projects. What does sustainability look like when you're trying to build off of grants like this? What have you seen work?
Yeah, so sustainability is definitely a challenging component of a lot of these things. Some organizations definitely fill it into, say, their regular donor schedule or their regular funding they get from, say, tuition or something like that. That's definitely something that happens. And organizations do that kind of thing, but not every organization can do that. So I tend to think in those kinds of cases about more of a scaffolding approach. So especially VR, XR, things like that are very friendly for this kind of thing. So you apply for a particular grant, and once you receive it, you get started on a project. Say maybe you started with a foundation and a relatively small project, maybe only impacts a relatively small group of students or a relatively small group of the public, something like that. From there, you kind of have your proof of concept, but you also probably had some lessons learned about areas maybe you want to improve, or places that maybe things didn't go exactly how you expected them to go, or something like that. And even if it went perfect, there's probably more ideas that you have about how you can make it even better. So that's where the next kind of stage comes in. So maybe you apply for a different grant from a different organization. It could be another foundation, it could be federal funding, something like that, that kind of builds on that same project, but takes it the next step up. So grant makers generally, there's a few exceptions where a few foundations might be willing to fund you just for general support or continuing support on a project. But generally grant makers are looking for that innovation, but VR, XR, always a spot for innovation, right? There's always places that you want to go, the next place that you want to get to, a new feature that you can incorporate that could somehow improve the experience. So you have an opportunity to apply for another grant where you're supporting still some of the same kinds of projects, but now you have this new additional component that still makes it grant friendly in that kind of space. So you kind of scaffold on that continuous improvement kind of aspect. So you can't really stagnate, but I also don't think that you would be very successful stagnating, even if you had all the money in the world, because your technology would just get old and relatively sad compared to what everyone else is doing if you stuck with it.
Absolutely. Well, thank you very much. It was really informative, and hopefully we can get some links to get people connected up with you and get some more new projects underway. We appreciate you coming and chatting with us, Liz and Marianne. And next up is going to be another round of lightning talks that will kick off at the top of the hour. I'll see you then. Thank you.
Thank you.
With all my favorite colors, yes, sir. All my favorite colors, right. My sisters and my brothers, see them like no other. All my favorite colors. It's a good day to be, a good day for me, a good day to see my favorite colors.
Hello, good morning, and welcome to our first lightning round session of the morning. Our first presenter for the session is Nick Smirner from the Creative Learning Initiatives at Penn State University. And Nick will be speaking about traveling without moving, IMAX Labs Experience Catalog, and IMAX Excursions. So Nick, take it away.
Okay, great. And are we seeing the correct screen?
Yes, we are.
All right, fantastic. Hi, thank you so much for having me to the conference today. And since this is a lightning round, I'm just gonna keep rolling. So what we're actually working with at the Immersive Experiences Lab is creating a resource that we're calling the Experience Catalog to provide a really fast and easy clearinghouse for faculty who are interested in taking their students on virtual field trips, on taking their students up close and personal with, you know, microscopic scientific processes inside the human body. We want to provide a place where when they have the enthusiasm and the interest to do that, they can really just have a one-stop shop to find material that's appropriate and easily accessible and contextualized to bring into their classes. So that's what the Experience Catalog sets out to do. What it currently contains is over 300 hand-chosen and sometimes internally created by instructors at the university, 360-degree video experiences. We've begun just this month adding augmented reality apps that we're choosing. These are largely free, but sometimes paid apps that we find to have really high potential for educational usefulness. And then we're also working with over 50 virtual reality apps as well. And trying to keep those to a variety of fairly accessible and untethered headsets. So Oculus Quest and Go and other inexpensive devices of that sort. What these look like, so in addition to the actual content, so the video in the case of 360 or the apps in AR and VR terms, we're also then adding on some supporting context. So drilling down and taking a look at that. Of course, we're providing the title and the description from the content creator, but we're also then, you know, looking at all of this content. And so we're able to provide some information that we think instructors would find useful for what's working well, what's going to be educationally beneficial. We're defining what sorts of academic disciplines these materials would fall into, generally trying to assign those to two or three, so that we're spreading this content around, providing some really useful keywords to be able to search this, and trying to use a shared taxonomy across all of the catalog to make that really, really powerful. And then what we're also adding is a level of guidance in terms of video, in terms of AR, a level of integration between reality and the augmented layer. And then with virtual reality, a level of interactivity to try to make it clear without even taking a look at it, just how led you're going to be through the experience. We're also, of course, trying to make it clear that some of this content is viewable even without those headsets or standalone devices. So I'm making it clear you can look at some of this in just a browser, use your smartphone, add it to a cardboard headset, et cetera. now that we have a fairly large pool of content built out in the catalog, we also realized that we could take those experiences and roll them together to provide some more rich experiences. And so, as a lot of you probably were in March 2020, we realized pretty quickly we weren't going anywhere anytime soon. I love to travel, and I know that instructors love the travel component of things like our global programs. And so what we wanted to do was take that 360 video content, add in the augmented reality and virtual reality, and make some really great field trips. So we've been working on that for the last year. We currently have 10 plus virtual tours. We're adding more all the time. And we go all over the world. And so with those tours, what you're going to find is that we're like I said, packaging together the 360 content that's in the catalog and then adding in supporting elements. And we're breaking these tours down into categories like urban living, nature, the environment, cuisine, art and culture, so on and so forth. And so what we have with each of those, we generally try to put at least 10, if not more, 360-degree video experiences that range in length from a minute to 20 minutes, depending on where it is that we're going and what we're looking at. Then bring in things like 3D models that are readily available online on tools like Sketchfab. We're making use of like Merge Cube, which is an inexpensive printed cube that allows you to hold a 3D model in your hands to actually view that content. We did create a sample activity to bring this into the classroom. We're using the Harvard See, Think, Wonder model as a basis for this. And this is fully customizable. You can download the Word document. So for an instructor who wants to take this into the classroom, they can get started right away using this as a jumping off point. So I want to stay with my time here. I know we have a lot of other great presentations. I'll be curious to hear your questions, and I'd love to find out if this is something you'd like to work on with us. So thank you for your time.
Thank you so much, Nick. That's terrific. Our next presenter is Kevin Wong. Kevin is a graduate student at Rutgers University's School of Communication and will be speaking about observing immersion within Twitch, a move from offline to online. Kevin, go ahead.
Thank you for that. Let's share my screen. All right, hope y'all can all see that. Thanks, Barbara, for that. Thanks, Barbara, for that quick introduction. Hi again, I'm Kevin Wang and from Rutgers University. I'll be talking a little bit about how I moved from an offline research project to an online one. And then if time permits, a little bit about some of the findings from the offline project. So to start, the original project, I kind of want to give a little bit of background on that. It's centered around a facility known as VR World, which is located in Midtown Manhattan, and they like to call it a VR theme park. And for the project, I really, I received all the approvals from my university regarding the IRB and all the documents and forms and interview templates that were associated with the project as well. I even managed to get into contact with the CEO of VR World. And we exchanged a bunch of emails, kind of going back and forth. I had a phone call to kind of go over exactly what both of our expectations were as far as the project. And so hopes were very high, and we were both very excited to be working with each other and working on this project. But sadly, with COVID-19 and the COVID-19 shutdowns literally occurring on the very day of our first in-person meeting, the entire project was basically put on hold. And to this day, it's still on hold. So it's quite frustrating, and I'm sure, you know, we've all experienced something of this caliber in the past year, but nonetheless, I had to continue forward. I didn't really want all the resources that I put into this to kind of go to waste. And so from there, I really had to think hard about what I was going to do and what my next steps were going to be. And that's where my advisor kind of stepped in and really helped out in terms of talking things out and wrestling with the ideas on how to move forward. And in the end, I think what it really boiled down to was establishing the essence of the project, the essence of the offline project. And that was really trying to understand immersion and empathy, and kind of how these concepts intertwine and mingle within the immersive virtual environment. And from there, I really just needed to find another context to apply it to. And that came in the form of the digital or online context. And that's where, again, my advisor helped in terms of kind of discussing various platforms that I could look at, streaming platforms like YouTube or Twitch or even social media like Instagram or TikTok. But I really gravitated towards Twitch in particular because it was something I was more comfortable with, more familiar with in terms of how the live streaming function works. And that's kind of how the project really developed in terms of how it moved to the online space, really using my network to talk things out, but also kind of acknowledging and absorbing what was going on in the real world. I think it was also conducive to me, being able to move forward and also realizing and discovering the essence of the project was also very helpful. And even though there were very strict quarantine restrictions, I still had deadlines in terms of finishing out my coursework that last year and progressing forward. So I wasn't really able to revise my IRB or provide an addendum or submit an entirely new IRB. I really had to stick to my original one that I didn't quite think allowed me to give out questionnaires or conduct interviews through online means to the streamers that I was observing. And so ethically speaking, I think my IRB really only allowed me to observe people in the online space. And with those restrictions revolving around quarantine, I really could only do work from the safety of my home. But luckily, I did have access to a computer and access to the internet, so I was able to do some sort of online work. Moving over to kind of what I did or what I observed in the online space, I had a couple of research questions, but the one I want to highlight here is, can empathy be solely observed through VR gameplay? And if so, how is empathy elicited in these virtual environments? And so I conducted 17 observation sessions that are followed by memos. Each session lasted approximately 45 to 60 minutes long. And I observed these titles in particular because they were of the horror or suspense genres. And then from my memos and observations, three major themes kind of arose, and they were vocal expressions, bodily expressions, and role-playing. And I want to highlight role-playing here in particular because you might think it could be a combination of vocal or bodily expressions, but it's really the kind of careful curation of a narrative that the streamer creates and almost encompasses and then portrays to their audience. And I had a couple of findings, but one I want to highlight here is that empathy is actually very difficult to solely observe. I'm sure some of us already knew that, but generally studies are utilizing interviews and questionnaires, things like the IRI, the Interpersonal Reactivity Index, to kind of pinpoint whether empathy is induced or elicited. And within the IRI, I also want to highlight one of the four subcategories, which is perspective taking. I think perspective taking relates very closely to one of my themes that emerged from my observations, which was role-playing. And so to my research question, I think, yes, empathy can be observed. It's just to a very broad and general degree. And I think in order to understand empathy to a finer granularity, we definitely need other methods and other measurements to accompany those observations. And there were difficulties with observations and the platform itself, but I could talk more about that in the Q&A. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Kevin. So for our next presentation, we'll jump across to Parma, Italy. Taliesin Hall, an independent researcher in sustainable design and anthropology, and Federico Monaco, research fellow at the University of Parma, will be talking about XR literacy for healthcare education.
Hi,
presenters,
everyone.
Go ahead.
I'm so happy to be here, and really, the main thing about this is we are researchers in VR for e-learning and simulations in healthcare education, which means we try to build the gamified VR areas that future nurses and doctors and surgical practitioners can get some of their first experience practicing in. And we're really just in the beginning phase of integrating our lab into the processes of the larger university as a whole. And really what this presentation is about is sharing some of our limitations and frustrations, transferring traditional academic and institutional knowledge and connecting that really functionally with VR. The first thing I'd like to do is offer everyone to, rather than simply see me interact with another PowerPoint, I'd like to switch it up just a little bit. In the chat, you have a link to the slides which contain embedded 3D objects. By far the medium we found most successful for integrating what people already know how to do, set up Moodle courses based off of existing syllabi with small amounts of digital media interspersed. Considering that, let's carry on with the presentation. Can everyone see my, not that screen, sorry. There we go. So here we have one of the first prototypes we worked with, simply a arm where you can practice IV injections for nurse training. We built this in really just a matter of days with existing tools like Gravity Sketch. We're working with Blender, Unity, really a lot of the same software, GitHub, Mozilla that so many other presenters mentioned. And we're trying to basically show the rest of the institution what we can do with VR if we can manage to get over the unfortunately very existing digital divide. We have a lot of professors that don't always know how to use Google Docs, don't always know how to interface with the newest technology. We talk about QR codes and reference links and they have no idea. Really what we ended up having to do was figure out how to demonstrate what VR can do completely separate from having anyone actually experience VR. So we're talking about showing people maps, letting people interact with small virtual environments like this here. If anyone actually has a VR device, you can go ahead and open this up in there. This is an example of existing space that we actually work in. Our office is right over there. And we've attached various types of digital media that serve as examples of the types of tools you could add. And this was met with basically, give me something I can read in an email. How about you do a VR video recording of our most recent meeting? Not really taking advantage of the opportunities of VR, not really accepting the fact that this is a potentially hugely beneficial technology for coronavirus and quarantine conditions. And what we ended up doing was really focusing on being able to have conversations with our peers across different departments, completely independent of the computer software itself. Instead of trying to have them play with Gravity Sketch and understand what they could do with their own departments, instead we're working with analog tools and traditional communication that just basically gets down to stakeholder involvement, having the students, the professors, and the general public give us what type of skills they need developed, and then we figure out how those skills can be developed in VR. Just one or two more examples we have here. This is a mock-up of the entire floor that we're on in our department. And as we're slowly working, we're going to have the map of the entire campus, of the building, of the floor, and then eventually you'll be able to see that previous VR room with the surgical dummies and preparation areas all laid out in here. So if you have the correct software and hardware, you can navigate from Google Maps or maybe a future Unity-based engine that people are talking about. You can access the University of Parma, the simulation hub, and all of our resources in a VR environment completely immersive. That's our goal, at least in the long run. For right now, we're working with the doctors on campus and the professors nearby to try to integrate more of our work into what they're doing. How am I doing on time?
We're just about bumping up to time. So if you could wrap it up, that would be great.
Wonderful. The last thing I want to say is pretty much everything we're doing is entirely based in open source technology, and that is very much a part of our methodology and values. Thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, thank you so much. And our next presentation has a very large and diverse group of collaborators behind it. Susan Lakin, Tamara Carroll, and Joe Geigel from the Rochester Institute of Technology. Kelly Jan, an architect. Christine Radarsky from the Rochester Public Library. Jennifer Bannister from Rochester Center for Teen Empowerment. And Jose Da Costa from the Clarissa Street Reunion. Their presentation is Clarissa Street AR Experience, Revealing the Lost Architecture of a Historic African-American Community. Please go ahead with your presentation.
Thank you very much. Let me just share my screen. Okay, I've got my PowerPoint up. Hopefully you can see that. And I appreciate the introduction. We have a long list there. As you said, my name is Susan Lakin, and I am a professor in the College of Art and Design at RIT. I'm also co-chair of Frameless Labs, which is our XR initiative at the Rochester Institute of Technology. And for me, personally, it was around 2010 that I began to explore augmented reality with my students in a class assignment to animate paintings from the permanent collection of our local museum. And it was this work that really brought light to how augmented reality can engage new and also younger audiences, in this case, to historical artwork. So today I'm fast forwarding about a decade to today. And I'm here in Rochester to share a recent AR community project that I'm developing to reveal the history of a once thriving African American community. It was a vibrant community that has a legacy dating back to 1810, located here in Rochester. Specifically looking at this street down here, which is Clarissa Street. You see the marker there going all the way down up into the freeway here. This street back in the mid 20th century was lined with successful Black owned businesses. But you can see today on this map, it's has many vacant lots and parking lots lining the street today. Included in this, what was once a commercial corridor of Clarissa Street, was an internationally known jazz club called the Pifod. It opened in 1953 and was a famous stop on the Chitlin Circuit, attracting musicians such as Count Basie, Miles Davis, Sarah Vaughan, George Benson, just to name a few. And in those days, it attracted students from my university as well, which was just around the corner. The original location of our university was just around the corner from the Pifod. Today, the former location of the Pifod is a parking lot, as you see depicted here. And our goal for the AR experience is to overlay historically accurate 3D models of demolished buildings at this former location to serve as part living museum, locative research lab, and community gathering place to engage the public with this important history, as well as to try to help unpack some of the root causes of segregation and racial inequality, such as the injustices that led to the Rochester racial uprisings in July of 1964, depicted here. These situations contributed also to the demise of these commercial businesses that were once lining this street. The Interstate 490 now crosses Clarissa Street, and with augmented reality, we can provide a visual comparison between the past. On the left here, you see Latimer Funeral Parlor, and then on the right is an image of the same location today. As Rochester embarks on urban revitalization plans, recognizing the history of these neighborhoods is important to help build a more resilient, inclusive, and equitable community. And our hope is that the AR project will contribute to this goal. Since 1996, past and present residents of this community gather annually at a reunion to share stories from the past. The event attracts upwards to 10,000 people with music on 5 stages and a display of photographs from back in the day. This was one of the first events that I attended when I moved here to Rochester in 2000 to teach at RIT, and where I learned about the legacy of this neighborhood. Since that day, I've really wanted to find a way to share the history with the broader Rochester community. And so a few years ago, I pitched the idea of an AR experience to the Clarissa Street Reunion Committee members who recognized and were receptive to using AR as a means to engage the public year round. So as you see, we have many community groups that are collaborating on this project, currently archiving the history of the neighborhood, doing some intergenerational interviews between teens in the community and the elders to help really tell the stories and all of their stories with augmented reality. And here's a list of additional members of the RIT community that I've recruited to work on this, everything from history, computer science, art and design, as well as our university archivist. And further community outreach that I'm doing to bring together scholars with expertise in American history, music, and urban development who have partnered with us as well too. So stay tuned. We are continuing to work on this project. It's definitely a long-term project and really appreciate the opportunity to share a bit about this today. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Susan. So our next presenters are Vanjessica Gladney, a graduate student in history at the University of Pennsylvania, and Megan Moody from the University of Rochester's library. They are presenting on Augmenting University Legacies, the Penn and Slavery Project AR Tour. Presenters, please go ahead.
Thank you, Barbara. So I'm Megan Moody, the Immersive Technologies Librarian at the University of Rochester, and Vanjessica.
I'm Vanjessica Gladney, a second year grad student in the History Department at the University of Pennsylvania.
And we'll be talking today about the Penn and Slavery Project AR Tour. But before we dive in, we'll play a short video. And actually, I think I have to do a new share because I forgot to share my sound. All right. Yeah, there we go.
Hello, and welcome to the Penn and Slavery Augmented Reality app. The original intention of this project was to spatially locate the university's role and complicity in the institution of slavery onto the current campus. Over the process of creating the app, we decided that this history of slavery, though wedded to the institution, shouldn't be bound to its campus. You can participate from wherever you are and learn about the student research which helped to shed light on this history. The tour has six stops, each of which tells a part of the history of Penn's deep relationship to slavery, the university's founding, its history as an academic institution, and the experience of marginalized Black and Indigenous lives. This app has given us the opportunity to creatively present, manifest, and reveal the university's legacy in an informative and engaging way. Download the app in the App Store and Google Play Store to learn the role slavery played in the foundation of the university and the country, and join the conversation.
So we began the project in the fall of 2017, looking at the ways that slave ownership helped connect the University of Pennsylvania to the institution of slavery. A bunch of early trustees and faculties were slave owners. But then we decided to complicate the nature of complicity and look at the ways that Penn sought donations from Jamaican and South Carolinian slave owners in the early 18th century, the way that med school professors used their research to certify scientific racism, which was used to prove the ideas of racial inferiority and then later justify slavery. And we also looked at the ways that slave owners are still honored with monuments and buildings on the campus today. Next slide. And when we started thinking about the concept of honoring things on campus, we started looking around and noticed what other legacies were memorialized. So there are a lot of plaques recognizing prominent donors. And here you see a map of very important trees on campus, but the legacies of slavery on Penn's campus remained hidden. So we decided to reveal them. Megan?
So the AR tour was created to serve as what Vanjessica has called a virtual interruption on campus. Many XR experiences allow users to escape into other worlds. We instead wanted them to see their surroundings in a new way. AR allowed us to create rich multimedia learning experiences driven by student research, bringing together 3D models, video, voiceover narration, archival documents, and more to reveal this history, all while the user is situated in Penn's bustling campus. The app was created by an interdisciplinary team of historians, student developers, library staff, and XR firm Dream Syndicate. We first prototyped two experiences in spring of 2019, then built the application over the summer and fall of 2019. The project was then transitioned to Dream Syndicate to finalize the application, and COVID-19 did impact our timeline, but we launched this February. We'll now briefly discuss some lessons learned in the future of the project. We encountered issues of access concerning accessibility, usability, and privilege. The application has captions and voiceover narrative throughout. Users can also access the content no matter where they are located. So this was an added benefit for the pandemic. The app also provides in-app instructions and detailed instructions on the website. Regarding privilege, focus group feedback highlighted issues with campus policing and how people are treated when they visit campus, as well as not everyone having access to the required technology. These are ongoing discussions.
And this was a new project for all of us. We faced a lot of issues that we didn't think we were going to come across. Penn offers a lot of opportunities for student research, but the Penn and Slavery Project was very different. It's entirely student driven. All of the research posted on our site and featured in our app, the images posted on our site and featured in our app are all a result of undergraduate work. And it's uniquely interdisciplinary, so it allowed students to reach past the boundaries of arts and sciences and interact with members of like student design and the library. And it was really cool to watch the university come together in this one project. And it's incredibly public facing. So while we're building the app and building the website, we really had to think about the language and images we use and what we wanted our research to actually do. Next slide. And it's had a big impact. Our work has created change. So after our first presentation, the university established a faculty working group to make sure there was ongoing institutional attention. The Penn Medicine and the Afterlives of Slavery project, developed after our research about race science to examine the ways that that history has affected our medical field today. And last summer, the school announced its plan to remove a statue of a prominent slave owner and slave supporter, George Whitefield, from its campus. And earlier this week, the Penn Museum announced its plan to repatriate the remains of Black Philadelphians collected by an early med school professor. Next slide. So there's a lot of information that we didn't have time to cover today, but if you want to learn more, please download the app from the Apple Store the App Store on Apple and the Google Play Store. Check out our website, and there's a link to instructions on how to download and use the app on our website. And mostly, we just want to say thanks for listening. Let us know if you have any questions, and just quickly pay attention to all the people who worked so hard to make this really cool app and really cool project come to life. So thank you for listening.
All right, thank you so much. That was a great presentation. Our final presentation in this session comes from Adam Brown from Columbia University and Pariksha Dave from Columbia University as well. They will be speaking about virtual reality for enhancement of learning and engagement in undergraduate biochemistry. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Barbara.
Hi all, can you see the slides?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great, starting from the beginning properly. Good morning, everyone. I'm Adam Brown. I'm the program director of the Science of Learning Research Initiative at Columbia in the Office of the Provost.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Pariksha Dave. I direct Emerging Technologies at Columbia University IT.
And our two respective initiatives both operate within the sphere of scholarship of teaching and learning at Columbia, supporting primarily faculty-led efforts to innovate in their courses. In my case, my initiative's focused on bringing a formal research perspective to the scholarship of teaching and learning. And then Pariksha's initiative is focused on helping faculty incorporate emerging technologies like VR and AR and 3D printing into those kinds of projects. So today we're going to tell you about a project that we worked on with a really fantastic faculty member, Brent Stockwell, who's professor of biological sciences, and his effort to incorporate virtual reality experiences into his biochemistry course last fall. And our goal was really to approach this as an experimental project, as a formal science experiment where we recruited students in the biochemistry course randomly assign them to one of two groups, a virtual reality group or a control group, which was meeting on Zoom. In the virtual reality group, we had students wearing Oculus Quest headsets and meeting on the spatial.io platform. We generated and imported 3D GLB files as models of proteins and other molecules. And the students in the Zoom group had kind of a comparable experience, but everything was in 2D. So they were interacting with regular 2D diagrams in the Zoom meeting. And each group consisted of about 10 to 15 students. We had them meeting weekly for 30-minute sessions. We had seven sessions across the semester. And we wanted to measure the impacts of these small group experiences, which were sort of like office hours, going over topics related to the learning objectives of the week, having small group discussions, talking with the professor. We wanted to measure the impact of these experiences on the students' performance on assessments like exams, and also with a survey that would query their attitudes about the suitability of these technologies, VR or Zoom, for learning biochemistry in these small group settings. So our hypothesis was that the VR group would exhibit enhanced outcomes relative to the control group because of the greater immersiveness that one experiences in VR, as well as crucially this idea that there are 3D concepts that are really central to the learning objectives in biochemistry, and a 3D immersive experience with 3D assets would be the best way to address those learning objectives. In terms of the outcomes of the project, it was absolutely an instructive first foray into the world of VR in biochemistry. We did not detect any enhancements, you know, in a quantitative way, but we had many lessons to take away from it, and including a lot of positive and constructive comments from students at the survey at the end of the semester, which will certainly guide our future iterations. And you'll hear a little bit more about those future iterations in a moment from Pariksit. But first, some of the conclusions were kind of our original kind of motivating thought was that VR's advantages align with particular disciplinary elements in biochemistry education. So what that means is that you have to have really high quality 3D assets. You can see important details about the structures of objects like proteins, but then also you need to make sure that the activities that students are engaging in during these sessions match with the learning objectives, right? So if they're trying to understand something about the stereochemistry or the spatial orientation of different molecules during a reaction, then the activities during the session should match that. So involving viewing proteins, rotating them, moving different molecules around to see how they fit together, how they interact. And then also on the assessment side, it's really crucial to craft questions that specifically probe this 3D understanding of the mechanism and structure in question. Because you know, traditionally, assessments are based on a 2D learning experience. So we actually need not only to adjust the activities to match the VR's advantages, but also adjust the way that we assess students' learning, right? So it really aligns with the particular experiences that they're having with the 3D immersive experience and the sort of spatial understanding that students can more readily develop in that VR experience. Of course, we also noticed that getting used to virtual reality takes time. There's a learning curve for students. We'll talk more about that in a moment. Also that VR is very immersive individually, of course, but the spatial platform, it's not seem so immersive interpersonally, a little bit perhaps because the avatars are a little bit static, and also they're quite realistic, but it kind of was in an uncanny valley type of zone where they were a little off-putting looking rather than be kind of approachable and friendly. So it didn't quite feel like you're really interacting with other humans in that context. Of course, there are other unique challenges of VR. It becomes uncomfortable to wear these Oculus Quest headsets for long periods of time. And also students complained that it was not really possible for them to take notes while wearing the headsets, of course. So we are thinking about in future iterations, having designated breaks during the session where students can remove the headset, take some notes, and then come back into the session and talk about what they wrote down. And of course, we also are really interested in the ways that this technology and these types of experiences can be extended and scaled up in other disciplinary contexts. Certainly in the sciences, there's clearly a lot of potential for interesting virtual reality laboratory experiences. Anything where the experience is very active is going to be a great match. So quickly, we'll show you a couple of video clips of what these experiences were like.
Oh yeah, this is a protein that we brought in before, just to show you what a protein looks like. Someone was asking about how proteins versus small molecules. So again, the protein would be something like this, right? So here's a big protein. And then when it's catalyzing this reaction, it would really be this small molecule coming into that protein, the way these citrate and isocitrate. So that would be kind of the relative orientation of the protein in terms of size, protein in the small molecule.
So that was a clip from the very first session. You can see a lot of the students hadn't yet made their avatars. They had just kind of the default images there. But what you notice about the dynamic is that the students are all kind of gathering around the professor who's demonstrating something. But by the end of the semester, we had figured out that it was better to have each student have their own copy of the protein. So you can see in this clip that we're in this larger space, and each student now is interacting with their own copy of the protein model, rotating it, inspecting it, et cetera. So that was part of the evolution of our thinking about how to organize the activities over the course of the semester. So Prixit will tell you now about more of the technical elements and also about the improvements that we have in mind for this upcoming iteration.
Thank you, Adam.
And we are a little bit past time. So if you could wrap it up fairly quickly so we have some time for Q&A as well, that would be
sure.
Great.
Sure, we'll make this quick. I just want to give a bit of context on the technology. We had faculty member Brent Stockwell and his students who had limited or quite frankly, no knowledge of VR. And so we wanted to make sure the technology was not a burden. And so we did a full analysis of the hardware and the software. The reason why we decided to go with the Oculus Quest simply was the ease of use. And this was also a COVID hit. And so we wanted to make sure that this was simply as easy as plugging and playing, and getting on these platforms was super simple. For the next iteration, we're moving up the headsets to the Quest 2, which are a bit lighter. The graphics have improved as well. And we are utilizing Glue VR. Adam, you want to go to the next slide really quickly? The reason why we are deciding to move to Glue is because of the collaborative features, but also because the avatars have this sense of presence where their facial expressions are moving as you're speaking and as they are talking. So it feels as if I'm actually speaking with a student or a faculty member. And that was really important for the course as well. And we will be here to take some more questions at the Q&A as well. Adam, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you so much. That was great. So let's move to Q&A. And if anybody wants to add a question to the Q&A, please go ahead and do that. The first question is for Megan and Susan. Could you expand on why you chose VR to discuss history? Are there any concerns with this approach we should be thinking about? So this is a question for both of those presentations that are doing, you know, kind of similar AR based historical projects. Susan, you're unmuted. Do you want to go first?
Sure, no problem. First, thanks for that question. I think it's a really important question that we need to step back and reflect on how we're using technology. Just to clarify, both our projects are augmented reality, which is being able to overlay digital content onto the real world versus virtual reality, which is immersed into a virtual world. And so for me, I chose augmented reality. I felt was the best tool for this project because the history of this street is hidden, and it's just empty lots and parking lots. And so to be able to overlay what used to be this amazing, vibrant community on top of what's here today, I think really can then speak to the consequences of some of the injustices that happened along the way as well too.
And I think our project was along the same lines, like Vendesca was saying, that there are these other histories that are being represented on campus, but this one, which is so problematic and relevant, isn't public at all. And so we, again, with the deliberate choice of AR, we didn't want people to disappear into a headset. We didn't want them to go away. We wanted them to have to deal with this uncomfortable history. And there's so many parts of it. And I feel like AR allowed us to bring these different threads together. There's video and archival evidence and personal stories that are really powerful. And AR allowed us to do that. Vanjesca, did you want to expand on that at all?
I'm just using the AR in different formats also allowed us to talk about different the ways that slavery is present in different ways. So there's some that like rise up, and then there's a really cool exhibit where you're in the middle of, it's supposed to be like a museum exhibit, and you're encompassed by all these different artifacts and and portraits and textbooks of scientists who created knowledge that affects where we are today. And this idea that slavery, the legacies of slavery, are like all around you and encompassing when you're in academic spaces like universities like Penn. So yeah, using it deliberately and making sure that it tells a story about the space with AR. And I guess about the concerns, just as far as accessibility, access to technology, taking into consideration that not everybody has these devices, but everyone deserves access to this information, and how we wrestle with that and with the institutions that support our project. So those are some of the things that we were questioning.
Okay, great, thank you. A quick question for Kevin. Could you expand on the three measures of empathy you observed? How were these different than would be in reality?
Sure, yeah. And just to clarify, I wasn't necessarily trying to distinguish between in reality or the physical reality versus virtual reality. It was more so quite the opposite. It was how, you know, virtual reality kind of affects your physical reality and how they almost like combine together. And so two of my themes, for example, one of them is vocal expressions. And so vocal expressions were things like gasping or sighing or panting, right? But it's not necessarily due to the fact that the streamer themselves were tired. It was more so that they were so immersed or embodied into the virtual environment. And so that sort of affects how they interact or how they portray themselves in the physical reality. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. And a question for Adam and Perixit. Have you explored the advantages or disadvantages of having students make notes, annotations in VR rather than outside of it in order to overcome that obstacle you had mentioned?
Adam,
want to talk about that?
We have explored note taking in VR, and at times it's just not natural. It does take a bit of getting used to, and especially it depends on the platform we're in. With Glue, it represents a keyboard that the students use to type with their controllers. And it was a bit slow and a bit cumbersome. And also the notes weren't shareable. And so getting the notes out of the platform took it was actually impossible. And so we're looking at other ways to capture notes. We even thought about Glue has a web browser that you can pull up and actually log into something like your Google Docs. Typing your notes in there, but even that took some getting used to. And so one of the best things we did was just take off the headsets and have a session to just jot down notes was something that worked well.
Okay. I actually have a follow-up question for Jessica and Megan. And that is, I was very impressed by the ripple effects of your project that you described. And they're really not ripples, but waves, right? That the project made. And I was wondering what the university's kind of official support stance was towards your project. Did you get funding from Penn? Did you get help in advertising, distribution, those kinds of things?
So I think at first everyone was a little nervous that we were just kind of a bunch of like angry undergrads ready to take on the man, you know? But I think once we, you know, did our presentations and really explained that we'd conducted thorough research, and this was, you know, a legitimate scholarship conducted by some rock star undergrads, they really started supporting us, not only with a working group, but with funding. After I graduated, they hired me to be the public history fellow for the project. And I was really appreciative of having a job after graduation. And since then, they've helped fund our presentations, our symposiums, and a lot of the app. So as the research and the work intensified and became a lot more advanced, the university lent us a lot of support, and we're very grateful to have their backing in this project.
Okay. So I have actually a similar question. Oh, wait, there's another question that came in, so I'll hold mine. So this is a question for Dave and Adam. The question is, in my experience working with tools like note-taking outside VR environments, it's always really hard and distracting. Have you tried audio transcription that students could talk in real time so that students could talk their notes, while they are in VR? Have you looked at that at all?
Well, one thought I have is that audio transcription would work really well for notes that are primarily text, but because in the biochemistry context, there'd be a lot of diagrams that would be involved, it probably makes more sense to give students the chance to draw freehand on paper rather than using a speech-to-text system. But I can see how that would be really useful maybe in other disciplinary contexts with VR. Any other thoughts on that, Perixit?
I agree with Adam that while a speech to text may work, it's just in the context of biochemistry. It was crucial that they could actually draw out or write out notes in a manner that was efficient for the students.
Okay. I have a question for Adam and for Perixit as well, and that is, I'm wondering if a faculty member wants to do this kind of project at your institution, what's the intake process? What's the support structure for these kinds of things?
Sure, we have actually a grant program that we're working with the Office of the Provost. And it's the Emerging Technologies grant. It's part of the teaching and learning request for proposals at Columbia University. And so this grant provides faculty members with $20,000 stipend and in-kind support from both CUIT and Adam's team and our Center for Teaching and Learning to really kickstart these initiatives for teaching and learning. And it's a great way for these faculty members to not only get the equipment, the software, but also think about how to incorporate the emerging technologies and weave them into the curriculum.
Yeah, I would say that Columbia is doing a fantastic job of having really robust programs and financial support and in-kind support for faculty who want to do innovative things in their courses. So my initiative, the Science of Learning, has its own grant program. Perixit's Emerging Tech has its own grant program. The Center for Teaching and Learning has its own series of several different grant programs, and faculty can apply for these different grants in parallel. And I think it's really interesting to think about what the potential is when you combine, say, the emerging technologies expertise with the research perspective, with the real in-depth pedagogical perspective that the CTL brings. And we can do really, really fantastic work bringing all of those things together. And Columbia really, really values this and really supports it. And I think there's a lot of things to be excited about over the next several years as we continue to support faculty with all these types of innovative projects.
Okay. It's a good situation to be in. One quick question for Nick. You described basically how you're curating all these wonderful resources into packages. And I'm wondering who is doing this actual cataloging and curation? And I'm also wondering whether you have thought at all about moving that a little bit more towards a crowd resourced curation, if you could speak to that for a minute.
Well, so it's primarily me doing the curating right now. My team does help, and whenever we have faculty that like specifically approach us wanting to bring this into their class, we'll often work directly with them to track those materials down to address what they're after for learning. but yes, I would love to crowdsource this. I would love to bring more people into the fold on developing this. Absolutely.
Okay. So do any of you have questions for each other's presentations, I'm wondering? We have a couple minutes left for questions.
I actually had a question for Nick. Nick, if you can talk a bit about funding and creation of the content. Like that's so important, is how to get started, especially for the work that you're doing. Were you all creating the content yourselves? And if you can talk about the team that supports that as well.
Yeah, so the bulk of the content we're not creating ourselves right now, but there is content in there that's certainly been created within the university. We do have a number of like internal grant programs for faculty. One of those is our Teaching and Learning with Technology Faculty Fellowship, which puts a team of instructional designers and content specialists in partnership with a faculty member. I'm working with one this year within landscape contracting to develop 360 resources for students. We also, though, provide equipment through our libraries. So we have 20 some campuses, all of which have library lending pools that we provide 360 cameras and headsets and other gear to actually create the content out in the wild.
Thank you.
Okay. So we're 5 minutes away from the top of the hour, and we would like to give everybody kind of a 5 minute break before the next session of lightning round presentation. So I want to thank all of you presenters. This was really terrific and very interesting content. So thank you all for coming, for preparing your presentations, and for condensing them into this lightning round format. I know that's not easy, especially when you're full of enthusiasm about your projects. So thank you, and we'll see you again in 5 minutes.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the last lightning round panel. Just been amazing 2 days. Don't forget to stick around after this panel. There'll be a reception in Hubs, which should be a lot of fun. Okay, so why don't we just jump right in? Our first lightning round talk of this session is called Recoding Eels Through VR, Recoding VR Through Eels, Processes and Protocols for Decolonial VR, being presented by Michelle Brown and Kayla Goyal, both from Dartmouth College.
Kayla Goyal.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm just gonna share my screen.
First of all, Escaricasco, everybody. I'm Michelle Lee Brown. I'm Michelle Lee Brown, and I'm really excited to be presenting here today with Kala. And we're going to be talking about one part of a larger project called the Eel Elder VR. So I can do that. Thanks. So the first part, I wanted to answer some of the questions that John Bell had sent over to help me think about how to condense this into 5 minutes. And why I chose VR for this project was that it enabled me to focus on the relational protocols involved with the eels, and then thinking about relational protocols as they translated to VR builds and engagement, rather than get too in-depth in trying to build a biotechnical eel to start with. And also, the technology choices enabled me to be able to share this with communities. So the Eel Elder Project draws from eel relational protocols that we have in Iparralde, which is Euskal Dunak communities in Euskal Herria, what is now Biarritz, France. So it also is the first project to come out of the IP and AI guidelines. Now, this is part of the Indigenous Protocol and Artificial Intelligence Collective. They had a position paper which was published. It was about 199 pages. And the guidelines are in the beginning of it, and it's free and available online. And these seven guidelines are thinking about building AI and technical systems through Indigenous protocols, which then shape the technology protocols that we use. So some of the problems we encountered, obviously, there have been serious travel restrictions that happened. Some of this is being done via Zoom. And one of the things I had to do as part of this project is the eel elder that you interact with in the game. What it does is it gives you certain teachings, and they're in our language, so they're in Ushkara. And part of the things I agreed to was that I would become a better speaker myself, because that's something the cultural consultants wanted. It means a lot to them and shows sort of my reciprocity and my taking this seriously for me to become a better speaker of our language. So that's been happening over Zoom. Some of the relationship building is taking a little bit longer because sometimes face-to-face is much more important. I mean, not more important, but it's a little bit speedier to help build relationships and exchange protocols. So we're kind of working through that through distance mediums like Zoom. And it's also, I'll be honest, balancing finishing my dissertation and going on the job market while you're in the midst of trying to build these relationships, you know, and it's intertwined with your everyday life, and those parts of my life path happening moving forward has been a bit challenging for me, but I've learned a lot going through this process about how they can kind of impact each other in different ways. So if anyone has any feedback on how to balance that, I'd love to hear it. And I also want to talk about security and privacy concerns, but I'm going to turn that over to Kala, who can probably explain that more articulately than I can.
So while we were about to start our project, Oculus changed their guidelines around accounts. So previously you could have a specific Oculus account, and so you could have accounts specifically for headsets, but to make for easier data monetization, it's now linked to your own personal Facebook account, and they've done things like bricking headsets that they think are connected to fake, only for headset accounts. And so we've had to seriously reconsider which headsets we want to use and how, if we do go forwards with the Oculus, how we can ensure privacy, especially just because not everyone has a Facebook account. Not everyone wants a Facebook account. We don't want to force people to have to get a Facebook account just to play this. Mm-hmm. So currently we're still in the early days of this. This picture on the left here is from, I don't know how to put it, an experience, I guess, called Abzu, which happens under the sea. You're like an underwater scuba diver. It's beautiful. That's sort of the art style and ethereal feel we're going for. So we're kind of still in the art phase. The picture on the right here is from the proposal itself. It's like an early storyboard. We've done a lot of thinking and talking about how we're going to do this, and we've done research into how we're building it out. So platforms, target hardware, security protocols for culturally significant teachings and information, because there's some information and teachings that we don't necessarily want to be public and easily accessible by bad faith actors. So we've done some research into how we're encoding that.
So,
success is always arbitrary, of course, but to us, success is a lot around testing attitude shift towards eels, like potentially on an individual level, potentially on a larger level. So we might do studies on individuals and see how they feel about eels after a couple sessions of being in this space. Also the number of downloads, tracking hashtag usage. Another important thing to us is the ability to share the builds, processes, and protocols we're using here with other communities so that they can build their own culturally significant projects more streamlined than us.
So the takeaways from the project, for me, I was nervous at first. I know eels aren't, I love them, but my family, I come from a family that were caretakers. So like in our area around Mieritz, we would help take care of the eels as they came in, and they've been over harvested. And it said to take about 200 years for the eel populations to return. It doesn't stop people from eating them still. And it agitates me in a way, and it was hard for me to trust that other people were going to get or understand like how important this was to me, because part of the, it has two outcomes, the project. One is to help people sort of care more for eels and understand how amazing they are and how fragile right now their chance of survival is if we don't do something. But it was also to think about the relational protocols we have and how can we continue those in different ways. And what I've learned is that collaborators from many backgrounds are actually really helpful, and they contribute so many things to the project, including making sure it's appealing to a wider audience. Because when the eel does give you a teaching, it is in our language, but there's so many other interactions before that that can appeal to players from many backgrounds. And I've learned so much from trusting people and working with them. It's just become better and better as, you know, they've pushed me and helped me think about it more and more in careful ways. And also being clear about our core values and purpose, obviously, what it means, why we're doing it. And also that helps limit it as well, because you could iterate more, build more on it later, but understanding what it needs to be in the initial builds has been really helpful. And for me, it's also been really important because my work is relation oriented. And so that also means thinking about the people on the project with me. This is kind of me paying forward a lot of the mentorship or support people have given me or opportunities, and thinking about what are some people involved in the project? Like, how can working on this help them? Or how can we do other things to help them with what they want to do moving forward, you know, with their career and life goals? And I'm going to turn it over to Kala to add more to that.
So we should try to wrap it up pretty soon if you can.
We're, this is like the second to last one. So almost done. We can skip past most of the last one. Basic stuff on a lot of what I've learned so far with working on this project is just working with marginalized communities that you're not personally part of, that you may be unfamiliar with. One important thing I've found is to make fewer no assumptions. We are all, well, no, I shouldn't say all. Most of us here, I would say, are brought up in a very Western cultural centric viewpoint. That's the society we live in. And so we have a lot of cultural assumptions we make without realizing them that other cultures and communities might not make. And so asking if certain aspects of development are off limits, if certain documents are not okay for you to look at, asking to make sure you understand things, just asking a lot of questions can be important. Another good way to go about it is just gaining a basic understanding of the history of the culture through public documents, while understanding that any public documents are likely to still be flawed because of who history is often written by. I'm gonna skip past most of my stuff and just gonna go to the next slide though.
So the feature, this is the first start, and we'd like to eventually build a prototype, but thinking about how to sort of code the AI and within the eel, within a VR system, was the first step to actually building sort of a biotechnical eel. So that is a longer term project. And for me, again, I want to help other people involved with the project because it means so much to me, and it's a way for me to give it forward to think about what they might like to do in the future and how this can help them.
I started working.
Thank you both. Oops. Really, really interesting project. If you have questions, don't forget to just, as you they occur to you, put them in the Q&A box and we'll come back to them at the end. So the next lightning talk is Exploring Marker-Based Augmented Reality for Geosciences Outreach by Dorothy Ogden from the University of Alabama at Birmingham Libraries.
All right. Morning, everybody. So I want to share with you today a really interesting collaboration that actually evolved because of COVID. And that is in June of 2020, Stephanie Drumheller-Horton from the University of Tennessee Department of Geosciences contacted me and said, I am trying to figure out how to make my labs for geosciences that were previously hands-on virtual, and I'm not sure what to do. Do you have ideas? And I said, yes, I do, because I knew they had been 3D printing a lot of their models for use in labs, which meant that they had an X-Engine 3D scanner, which would allow them to make 3D models that had surface details that could be used for augmented and virtual reality. So the first thing that we talked about was Sketchfab. We set up a couple sessions with some of her graduate students to talk about how Sketchfab worked, how 3D digital models worked, and they were able to set up an account and put some materials in there that got integrated into a program called the Tennessee Governor School for the Sciences and Engineering, which is a STEM outreach program for students in high school in the state of Tennessee, and then also Geology 102 and some activities in Geology 320 that they teach. After that was done, we started talking about how augmented reality could be integrated into other activities that suddenly needed to have either a virtual component or to be totally virtual for outreach. So one of those was talking about whether or not we could use AR to replace interactive kiosks at the museums of Western Colorado. One of Stephanie's collaborators, Julia McHugh, was about to launch an exhibit that had a lot of iPads that were touchscreens where visitors to the museum could manipulate models by touching, and were wondering if there's another way to present that information. So I looked at using their models in different platforms for augmented reality. At first I tried Adobe Aero and Adobe Dimension, and you can see that the digitized model of an Allosaurus specimen. With Adobe Aero, although I liked it, at the time when I was trying this out, it wasn't available cross-platform. It was only available on iOS devices, which meant that the team, which was distributed, couldn't test the models. So I kind of went back and did some more research, and I found something called AR.js that is open source on GitHub. It uses a script in a web page to place a model using augmented reality, as well as a marker and a QR code, which meant that any mobile device that had access to the internet and could launch a web browser and read QR codes could load these models. And so I was able to put together a prototype. This is what it looks like. So this is a screen capture from my iPhone 6S last summer. So I can hang up the marker and the QR code on the wall. And then that model is moving because I'm able to pinch and spin and manipulate it. I'm able to pinch to zoom and look at details. And then this is another example. And then I actually have that marker for you all today. If you would like to try this, it should work through the presentation. You'll need a mobile device with the camera enabled that can read QR codes, and then you will have to allow it to open a web browser and run a script in that browser. This was really easy to set up, and I'm pretty excited. I still am pretty elementary in my coding skills, and I was able to walk through the materials provided on that GitHub page to get it set up and to get my own model into the demo. We think this will be really interesting for K through 12 education and K through 12 geosciences outreach, because it'll enable anybody with a mobile device to use AR on the spot. You won't have to download another application. You won't have to be in another ecosystem to make it work. We had talked about integrating this into a teacher workshop that was going to take place this summer, but the shop coordinator thought that maybe that would be better for another time, just with everything going on. But we are still planning to do that, hopefully as part of the outreach activities, and then also integrate this with the materials that were originally going to be 3D printed in outreach kits for geosciences available through the public library. So this is our group that initially put the idea together. And Stephanie and I are available for questions either about how this might fit into geosciences outreach in the future or into some of the K through 12 education workshops. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you. That was great. Our third lightning talk is Where We Stand, Black Theater and Storytelling in VR Project by Monica White Dino, hope I pronounced that correctly, from Dartmouth.
It's in Dunu.
In Dunu, yeah, great.
Thank you so much. So I'm gonna share screen here. Okay, so I am an actor, a director, a producer who has a genuine interest in Black storytelling across media platforms. And so I've had this interest in exploring VR for quite some time, but decided to in the pandemic to actually move forward with an idea that had been germinating for a while. And what the goal is, has been to create a safe space for Black people to do perform theater and produce theater and storytelling in a virtual space. And so I began building this platform with a team last summer. And essentially the platform is an African diasporic centered, or has an African diasporic centered focus. And we do have a working version of the platform now. And so today I'm just gonna outline a couple of lessons we've learned so far. And we're continuing to explore this because we're still in beta and still sort of figuring out what aspects of the platform work best and what things we'll continue to develop. And so the things we've learned in the process of building this so far is that VR does present a real opportunity to emulate the experience of being in the same space. That's the experience that we've been missing over the past year due to COVID. And so I think there's a lot of value in continuing to explore the virtual space for performance and storytelling, and also for teaching and learning for performance and production courses. While we're still testing the outcome of the platform, we have, we've discovered like a couple of different things that we'll continue to explore in my Black Theater USA class, which I'm teaching this spring. And I'm also teaching a Black Storytelling and XR course in the summer, where we hope to actually produce a workshop production of a very fascinating play. It's very difficult to stage in real life. Over the course of this time, we learned about various challenges. I think one of the most pertinent that I would discuss is the avatar challenges with avatars. And representation. There's a history of this misrepresentation of Black people through visual images, and the avatars that are currently available do not accurately reflect Black people in particular and people of the global majority at large. And so we recognize a need for more globally representative avatars and modeling, among other things. So we'll be continuing to build the platform and other technology. Some of this I'll be doing in collaboration with my amazing DALI team of students here at Dartmouth. Quick shout out to Mira, Chiao, Gia. We have Kelly now, and also Julian, Luca, Ricardo, and also Nick Bergen. So amazing students. I'll continue to work with my colleague, James Mahoney. We're also collaborating to address some of these issues. And another important lesson that has come out of this too is the importance of accessibility. A lot of these technologies are developed, and you can see even from the models that are used to develop it, the avatars, for example, some of the key features are designed around white men. And so I think it's really important to shift the gaze and shift the focus to be more culturally representative, and to also ensure access to a range of communities. So that's another aspect we'll be working on with this project. Thank you.
Thank you, another really fascinating project. If you have questions, please put them in Q&A and we'll get to them later. I know I have a bunch. Our next project is Freely Available, Emerging Technologies for Connected Learning and Simulation by Nicole Simon and Robin Sullivan. Nicole is from Nassau Community College and Robin is from University of Buffalo.
Thank you. Can I just switch on my screen? There we go. Okay. So I think some wonderful things have come out of the pandemic. I know that's hard to say for most people, but I'm both a STEM faculty member and I'm also an instructional designer. So taking a look at what my students needed when we first went remote, My students needed something that's freely accessible or low cost. They needed something that was easy to use, and they needed something that they could replicate in a very, very quick way. So by taking a look at different freely available resources, we want to take a look at what we really need for science lab, allowing students to manipulate variables, receive dynamic feedback, and facilitate some type of exploring and learning, making sure that students can investigate how things work on their own and how they can start to develop their own questions. That's essential for our science labs. We wanted to make the content focus about technology, engaging students in the scientific method, and creating a learning environment where they can develop those analytical skills. So by doing that, I was able to take not only some of the interactives that we could find online, but by able to take these interactives, allow students to start playing with them, taking a look at what they needed, and then rebuilding and sharing out some of the resources as far as labs. And that's what we'll take a look at today. So I'm just going to switch over to some of the interactives that we used. So as far as biology, you have plenty of different interactives where students are able to manipulate their lab equipment. They're able to look and replicate on their learning outcomes. They're able to take a look at what it is that they need to know in a real life clinical situation. And we feel that's very, very important for students going into the health science fields. More specifically, they're able to be in an environment where not only can they replicate it, but there's less damage control as far as what they do and what it is that we need to watch and mediate with. And I think that's important so that the students are in a safe environment. They can go forward and they can learn about what it is that they need for their lab. And if there is an issue, they can replicate it. So that's something that's extremely important that they don't necessarily have in their classes on campus. Another one that I took a look at was creating different models where they're able to change their frequency for physics and do curve fitting analysis. And I think one of the biggest takeaways was being able to use different simulations. So for my physics students, we use different simulations. I'll just pull one of them up for you, where they're able to replicate what it is that they do for class. And it's, again, freely available. The only issue was that I had to sit down and create the labs for them. Not a problem if you're writing up the labs anyway, where they're able to have an introduction. They're able to change different constants. They're able to apply the same forces and the same variables they would normally have in their lab. They're able to articulate the equipment. And from there, they're able to calculate all of their variables. Another one that I tried with my class was to take a look at different mirror for optics, where they're able to change those variables. And again, start to model what's going on that they would normally have in class. So they're able to create those simulations, they're able to alter what's going on, and they're able to take their data. I think this is extremely important to be able to replicate the same thing that you would normally have in class. And then from there, we've created little videos where the students are able to go back, watch these videos, not just myself, but they've actually created videos of what they've done in class to demonstrate their knowledge of what they've learned and apply those learning outcomes. So thank you. I'll turn it over to Robin.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Nicole. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the MTech Wiki project that is sponsored through the State University of New York at Buffalo. And this project will help you and anyone across the world find freely available emerging technologies for AR, VR simulations, and many other emerging technologies. My contact information is here, and I'll make sure that I get the slides to the planning committee for this event. But basically, please put this URL into your notes. It's suny.edu/emtech, and that takes you to the website. The big long title, formal title for the project is Exploring Emerging Technologies for Lifelong Learning and Success. And for short, we call it either MTech. The project has two different components. One component is a Coursera-based MOOC. I'm going to talk today about the MTech Wiki. And this is a wiki that anyone is able to contribute, freely available technology tools and resources. It can be used to complement the MOOC, but it's also available as a standalone resource. And it's socially curated, but it is moderated. So when somebody does submit something, it does go through a minor review process just to make sure that it's formatted the way we want it to be. And it, you know, might tweak some of it a little bit. But this is the blown up screen grab of that wiki. And it is organized, has about 500 different resources. They are tools and resources. We're going to focus on simulations for this really short introduction. But you can come here and search by 21st century skills. You can limit by what is your specific objective. And you can also limit by the Web 2.0 types of categories. We'll talk about simulations here. Please, there have been many, many resources shared throughout these couple of days. Please add them to the wiki. Our simulation section is only just beginning. So there's many tools that I have seen that I would love to see added. You can also earn a digital badge by doing so. I'm just going to highlight a couple real quick. Really quick. Photos and images are kind of the first virtual reality shifting time and space. So you can find many Creative Commons photos, 3D modeling and printing. Just one example is the 3D scanner app. Use your phone to create a 3D model, as was demonstrated slightly earlier. The simulations that Nicole had shared, here's just one that she had provided. a couple different tools for augmented reality. One I really like is that Merge Cube. You can now print that Merge Cube onto paper and you know, use it to hold the heart or the world in your hand in augmented reality. And finally, kind of the virtual reality, Google Cardboard, even though Google has gotten out of it, they're still out there and they're still a very viable tool, very inexpensive. And getting back to that photos in the caves, you know, you can't be there. So you can either look at a photo, and now you can also use your phone for virtual reality or some of the more advanced VR headsets. So is simulation always the best choice? Not necessarily. You know, sometimes you want to know, you know, what are the parts that make this up? So a diagram or schematic may be better. So you have to know what's your purpose. And I just want to share that URL again. Please add your tools and resources. So there's additional things that you can do to share this wiki and the MOOC with your campuses. They're linked to on this slide. Thank you.
Thank you. And so our last lightning presentation of the conference is appropriately called Using New Virtual Spaces for Conference Networking and Community. And it's being presented by Gina Sipley from Nassau Community College, and Robin Sullivan is back from University of Buffalo.
Thank you so much for having us. I want to begin with an apology because I was supposed to have my son napping right now and he's not, so he may make an appearance on this call. Robin, do you want to start?
You can go, Gina.
You want to start? Okay. So let me share my screen with you. All right, so a few months ago, before the pandemic began, I was set to attend the Association of Internet Researchers Conference in Dublin. And it was something that I felt conflicted about. It was an important time for me in my research studying the literacy practices of lurkers in Facebook groups, and it was and we were at the height of the lead up in the 2020 election. However, the cost of going to Ireland was quite prohibitive. And then when the pandemic hit, everything moved online, and I was, you know, excited not to pay the cost, but then a little bit saddened that I wouldn't get the chance to have the same networking opportunities that I would at a regular conference. And I was blown away by how the Association of Internet Researchers were able to create a conference that encouraged both synchronous, asynchronous, but also this new idea to me, serendipitous learning. And that's really what I want to talk about today. I highlighted my experiences in this blog for the London School of Economics. I'll put the link in the chat afterward if, you know, that goes into more detail. But there are two tools that I want to bring your attention to, GatherTown and Wonder. So, you know, my name is Gina Sipley. I'm an assistant professor at Nassau Community College. You can find me on Twitter at gsipley, and I'll have my email address up at the end. So virtual conferences are equitable, accessible, and sustainable, and they're going to be a crucial part of the post-pandemic university. Because they really are going to be this way, I think, to invite more people with our diverse range of needs into the space. And thinking about synchronous, asynchronous, and serendipitous, the thing that most people miss about face-to-face conferences are those unexpected interactions. Somebody that you go, you know, you bump into them on the way to get coffee, you meet them in the elevator, you stay up all night talking to them in the bar, you know, these types of things that seem like they can't exist, but yet can when you start to use tools that will encourage capriciousness and spontaneity and professional interaction. So GatherTown was the one that the Association of Internet Researchers used. And what they essentially did was they created this virtual world that was supposed to mimic some of the pubs that they were going to host events at in Dublin. And by leaving these virtual pubs open 24 hours a day, because the conference was truly global and people were participating across time zones, it allowed the opportunity for people to kind of bump into each other in these pubs and sit down and have a conversation. And they also use them as a way to play games with participants. So it was an opportunity to do, for example, pub quizzes, and they were going to have held a Irish folk dance, and we did it through the GatherTown with your avatars on GatherTown. And I am impressed by the strength of the professional connections I was able to make through this virtual world that now I'm presenting at conferences with folks I met there. I'm co-authoring papers, and I feel like I actually got more out of the virtual space here than I do at some other conferences. So there are two. GatherTown was what it was called when I went for Association of Internet Researchers in October of 2020, but it's now going by the name Gather. And there's another tool, Wonder. And I think both of these are things that you want to put on your radar. And of course, I'm sure there are going to be more and more iterations as time moves forward. But Wonder is the type of tool that's very quick to get up and running. And if you're running a small scale event or you don't have a lot of funding, that's where I recommend that you start. It's got an easy interface. It's a quick launch. If you've got participants who are not quite so tech savvy, that's the way to go. And it's free up to 1500 people. Whereas GatherTown is only free up to 25, and you're only gonna get a max of, you can have a max of 2,500 participants. And if you have an event that's larger than that, you have to kind of create different towns. And they have all where you can come up creatively with your own games to play, let's say in Wonder. In GatherTown, they're more easily integrated. And you have the option to sort of move through the space as your avatar. But then once you get really close, it pops up in a video screen and you can have that sort of Zoom-esque experience. So these are tools that I encourage you to think about as you're moving forward with your conference planning, and ones that I think really should be at the forefront of your mind when you're thinking about how can you include opportunities for serendipitous learning in any virtual event. So if you have any questions, you can reach me here on Twitter or on Gmail is actually easier than my faculty account at the moment. So I welcome you to stay in touch. I'll put the link in the chat, and I'm going to pass it over to Robin.
Thank you, Gina. Okay, so to wrap up, I'm going to talk a little bit about some additional considerations when creating a virtual event. Specifically, I'll talk about Virbella, Mozilla Hubs, and maybe just briefly on some other virtual worlds. There is a guide that has been compiled that you are welcome to download and please add to that. I'm definitely somebody that loves sharing, loves collaborative development of resources. So this guide has a lot of resources about creating virtual events. I'll put the link in the chat after we're done. But just got a little bit of inspiration for this concept that I've talked about at other places through some of the events you see on the screen. One of them was the National Serious Play Conference. I had assisted the conference planner with some of the ideas. She had to switch immediately right after COVID from an in-person event, which she's done for many years, to a virtual event. We also recruited some additional UB and SUNY colleagues when it came to actually facilitating. And some of the other ones, the one that is coming up that we're real excited about is the iLearn conference coming up in May, and we have a poster session, so I'll talk a little bit about that. So the first thing you want to do is understand who is your audience. As Gina had mentioned, some of the platforms need to have more tech savviness than others, and just make sure that you kind of understand what you're trying to do and who you're trying to do it with. We will return to some of those in-person conferences eventually, but we will have more of these virtual events. That is just a given. They have been so phenomenally available. You do not have to do that lengthy travel, so many people can share their knowledge with others. That's going to be happening more and more. The Verbella campus was used at the iLearn conference last summer, and it was one of my very first experiences. And you're walking around the halls and talking and going into side rooms with colleagues, and it's a different feeling than being in a Zoom environment. That glue session last night, thank you for another experience, for another platform opportunity. It was very similar. The tour of the island was something that one of my colleagues, Eileen O'Connor, who had presented yesterday, she had introduced me to this environment where they get together through courses and just to share. And you can pick up a tree when you're there and put it in your own island. This is of a picture of the poster session in Verbella. So you can go walk up to a poster session, talk to the individuals. The poster is much more dynamic than a paper poster. You can click on it and go further into depth. This is just a screen grab of what one of the main presentations looked like. And then the virtual events, when I've done some of the surveys, what is the thing that people miss most about going to a real live in-person event? And it's the networking. So here is, this was not a good picture because there were tons of people at the beach at the after party listening to a band. I need to get a better screenshot for that. Drove around the island a couple times in a boat with some colleagues talking about educational trends and watching the fireworks. And then as Gina did some folk dancing, we did some line dancing. Verbella, you can go there. It's free to check out. You always have a real person greeter on the island to talk to you and tell you anything you need to know. I do want to just, mention, keep in mind accessibility is very important. That's sometimes why I sometimes shy away from using these tools, because I'm not so sure how all demographics can access these environments. And just creating your avatar. Sure, they've gotten a little bit away from the Barbie type figure, but you still can't make yourself look exactly like who you are. and so here's just some links to some of the items. I look forward to our activities and hubs coming up. So thank you. Okay.
Thank you, everyone. Really, really interesting talks. And if you have questions, anyone else, please put them in the Q&A and we'll ask them. Robin, as you're reminding us, we will be in hubs right after this so we can take a look for ourselves. I'm hoping John Bell is gonna be leading some dancing there, though I'm not sure. just one question I actually have for all the panelists is, you're all actually using commercially available software and tools and platforms. And I was just wondering if you could comment on that versus using project or work platforms that would be designed specifically for academic use. I know Kala has already talked a little bit about the sort of changes to Facebook logins and privacy and those implications, but there are many others.
Well, I think I want to just add a little bit. So one of the tasks that I've recently been involved with is developing a checklist or a rubric that helps individuals look at some of the freely available tools that are promoted through the MTech Wiki and try to just provide some education. How can people self-assess whether or not that tool meets accessibility requirements, whether it honors your privacy of your data? And so it's really important when you are looking at these tools, especially when they're in the freely available tech category, you know, they're not truly vetted. And so campuses are actually kind of sometimes hesitant to say, oh yeah, you know, you can use that Virbela tool unless they've gone through their really big checklist.
Monica first. Okay.
Yeah, I was just going to clarify, we built an original platform, so we're not using something that's...
Yes.
I was going to say, for my students, it's very important that they have freely accessible or low-cost options right now. And then from there, we can start building out a platform. But I'm very much used to this environment. My students aren't. So being able to give them an environment that they're able to feel comfortable in is first and foremost. And then from there, we can build a platform going forward.
I want to tag on to what Nicole is saying, because Nicole and I teach the same demographic of students. And I think that community college students are disproportionately affected by the two prongs here, right? They are more likely to have their privacy violated. They're also less likely to be able to access tools that are more expensive because the institution they're attending doesn't have the funds to get the licensing for it or you know, all the other associated costs. So we really often with our students have to make very hard choices, but the most important thing is to be transparent about what they're signing up for, what they're engaging with, because otherwise we run the risk of exacerbating the digital divide.
Absolutely. Yeah, we're very cognizant of not what's just going on in the higher ed area, but K-12, especially in New York, K-12 has very specific requirements. So we want to make sure that the students are P-20 aware of what's going on.
I think what I think about is like my work isn't just for academia, it's for communities, right? It's community-based work. And I think Monica nodding your head too. It's like it's thinking about communities and the resources we have and how we can give back to those communities. Reciprocity is part of the work I do in like a larger sense, but also with this project. So for me, it was also thinking about something that was going to be available. That's why the Oculus Go was so frustrating when they demanded people's Facebook accounts, because that was mobile. People didn't need a computer to plug it into. So we could actually possibly have people experience it close to some of the rivers and streams where the eels come in, but we're still working on that. But for me, it's always thinking about larger community access, not just within academia settings.
I think it's also an ease of development thing in a lot of cases, because sometimes, of course, you have specific features or needs that commercially available products can't help with. But I feel like in a lot of cases, as we can see in the presentations we've seen in the last 2 days, in a lot of cases, building your own platform is just time that is taken that could instead be put in development elsewhere, because you only have finite amount of resources, time, people working on it, all of those things. And if you need to build your own platform, then you have to build your own platform. That's how it is. But if you don't, that's just a lot of time freed up, because a lot of this is just scaffolding that if someone's made it and you don't need to change it, why change it?
No, these are all, I actually wasn't saying we shouldn't use commercial platforms.
No,
I mean, these are all great reasons for using them, right? That it helps you get up and running faster, it can be cheaper, they can be more accessible. As Michelle's saying, actually on the other end, they can make things available outside of an academic community as well. So they can really be not just a jumping off point, but a kind of bridge outside of academia. Just relatedly, Monica, I wonder if you could just talk a little more about avatars and if you found other libraries of avatars that were more appropriate.
So we've been exploring that actually. One of my team members went on a search for, you know, the various possibilities for avatars. And so there are a couple things that we're running into. Number one, again, I mentioned the misrepresentation of Black people historically through imaging. And we found that it's really important to ensure that our avatars don't look like minstrel characters, for example. So trying to find a resource that actually looks like Black people. And so this is in this, you know, the previous question about, you know, using, building a new platform versus using an existing platform, why we have found it necessary to build a new platform is because most of the existing platforms were not designed with people of African descent in mind. And so it's a lot harder to come in and try to manipulate the space in a way that's safe for Black people when we experience a lot of cyberbullying and other forms of abuse in virtual spaces. And so, and we have been able to find like some like cartoonish looking avatars that can be used, but they're not appropriate for all of the types of work that we want to do. So one of the things we're doing is building a library of globally representative avatars as part of the project.
Great. So we have a few questions that have come into the Q&A. An anonymous question is, I found it really difficult to make contact with people in these virtual events when avatars are just flying by and you have no eye contact or way of knowing who this person is. Even entering an existing conversation is hard. Any tips? I don't know if you want to address that, Gina or Robin.
I can, I guess, just a tiny bit. These environments that have you kind of situated in a space. So when you get closer to people, the spatial sound gets more direct. And last night I was overhearing, somebody was having a conversation, does the platform change the facial expressions of the avatar based on what the conversation is? Artificial intelligence, you know, are the eyebrows raised when a question is asked? So, you know, it's definitely difficult. It's difficult, I find, in-person conferences to kind of break into that conversation where you don't know people. So it's just, I think, something we will get used to a little bit more. Kind of like we got used to talking in Zoom a little better. Dina?
And I just think there are ways, too, to keep, like, private spheres also within these spaces. You know, the pubs that were created in Gathertown had so many seats at a table, and where, you know, in real life, you could maybe share a seat with somebody, you could lean over their shoulder. Once that table was filled, you could not hop on until somebody else hopped off. So there are ways, and I think that was a choice made by the designers of that world. So there are ways to kind of encourage more, more casual communication. And then the thing that was nice about Gathertown was like your avatars are there, but then your video pops up. So you are seeing people's faces in the Zoom-esque way, and you could see somebody's raised eyebrow or their curious glance at you. And I think we're kind of moving toward a place where we need multiple streams of communication in order to understand the intent of the person conversing with us.
That's really interesting. And I know Robin makes a good point, which is that part of it's about the technology and what that enables, but part of it is about our facility to use it and comfort with it. And you know, just the kind of customs that are slowly developing within these social spaces. Dorothy and Nicole, I wonder if you could both comment a little more on VR labs. One of the things we want in the social spaces is serendipitous encounters. That's actually something you also want in the lab spaces, but is harder to program in as well.
I mean, I don't think I have that solved yet, so I will say yes. I think it's something that I've tended to solve in person as well by trying to make the physical spaces when we were in the labs more conducive to groups coming and using them, whether that's having a lot of monitors, having rolling furniture and whiteboards that maybe that could be integrated into the physical process of innovation or developing ideas. And I think that was useful, but that's one of the things I think you put your finger on, a really key problem that I'm not sure there's a really good solution for yet, just because you have to develop that structure around whatever event.
I agree. I think this is something that definitely needs more work on. I know from my students that when they're physically in the lab, they're obviously working in smaller lab groups, but being able to do this remotely, I'm able to put them in breakout groups. And while they still have the same learning outcomes, I'm able to give them different simulations using the same software and retool what it is that they're looking at for different variables. So they're able to approach a problem from different angles and then come back to the larger group and share. And I think that it's very invaluable because it allows the students a deeper dive into what's going on in their lab experience. And they're able to share different perspectives. So from that point of view, I think the simulations are working out almost better in some cases than the physical lab equipment.
And Michelle, did you want to add something? You say your box came out. Oh, okay. So actually, I'm going to give the last question to one in the Q&A that was answered earlier. But for Michelle and Kala, Adam Brown asks, amazing interdisciplinary project. Were ecologists and or organismal biologists involved as well?
I'll elaborate a little
bit. I saw you wrote an answer, but I thought everyone could hear.
So the nutshell version of this is coming from an Indigenous Aboriginal perspective in our relationships with the eels, and thinking about it sort of takes Fox Hurrell's work that all technical systems are cultural systems and sort of inverts that, like thinking about our cultural systems, how they can infuse technical systems. And then working through it that way and thinking about our relational protocols. The eel in the game is an elder, right? It's a very large version of the eel at the very end of its life cycle. And so you interact with it in the water experience as an elder, and you have to observe certain protocols or else the eel doesn't come back the next time. And you have to rebuild that relationship because it's giving you teachings if you show it you're ready. And you show that by proper behavior and protocols. However, on the website, we're going to have a lot of links and resources to marine biologists and ecologists talking about the eels and why it's important to understand them and just how amazing they are and how little we know about them, which for me is extraordinary. You know, and we've always grown up knowing that we'll never know all we know about them, but when they do come and we do have contact with them, that's all the more reason to cherish it, not the reason to dissect them and try to find out everything about them, if that makes sense.
Yeah, thank you. Gina, I was just thinking back to a panel I moderated a few weeks ago of people who run film festivals. And I asked one film festival director, you know, 10 times as many people saw the films this year as went to the festival last year. Isn't that great? And she said, absolutely not. The most important part of the festival is people standing in line and the conversations they have then. And you know, I know we can't totally recreate that, but I hope everyone will stick around and join us in Hubs after this. I'd say the experience after the first version of this conference last August in Hubs, just watching people talk to each other and have conversations really was one of the closest things I saw to the kind of serendipitous great conference gatherings that I've experienced. So thank you all the panelists on this panel and over the last 2 days, so many just great resources and really suggestive, thoughtful, exciting projects. We'll make all of the links and as much of the material available as possible and send it out. And I'll turn over to John Bell, who can say a few words and then help bring us into Hubs.
Thank you. And I'll echo once again, thank you to all the speakers. It's been really amazing over the last couple of days. I want to say thanks to a few of the people who are helping set this up as well. But remember, this is a Marvel movie. There's an after credits scene that we need to get to. So we will be going to Hubs after this. Let me share this real quick. So thank you, first of all, to the sponsors, University of Penn Online Learning Initiative and Dartmouth ITC Group. To the session leads, in particular, the glue session yesterday afternoon, Anthony Petrus, Edward Schneider, and Stephen Canning, and also to this morning's excellent grants workshop, Marianne Ellison, Liz Shea. The conference committee, everybody who helped organize all of this, Peter and Barbara and Rebecca and Mark. And of course, the people who actually made all of this happen behind the scenes, Catherine, who has not been behind the scenes, but has been doing far more than is easily apparent. So thank you very much. Jim Goodrich helped out with some of the setup as well. And Carla and Elena are the people who are largely responsible for the hub setup that you're about to go into. So thank you very much. And of course, to Anna Miller and her team of students at Penn, if you haven't been following the Twitter stream, they've been doing a ridiculously good job. I am incredibly envious of them. So please go check that out. There are little quotes with pictures. It's very nice. So thank you all very much for that. And of course, for all of you and your attendance.